everybody. This is Richard Sachs, your host on Lost Arts Radio, broadcasting worldwide on this show for September 11th, 2016, 15 years after the 9/11 events in this country that, according to some reports on Alex Jones, a lot of young people don't even know what they were at this point, probably thanks to the great educational system that they're all suffering from. But very significant anniversary, actually, that we may get a chance to talk about later, but we're going to go kind of quickly here because we got to get to our guest, Ken Rohla, who is an extraordinary combination of talents as an individual, actually. He's an engineer, designer, inventor, but also health teacher, live food advocate, and among the live food advocates, he's one of the very few that I know of in the world right now, actually, that is aware of the value of raw milk used correctly and does not consider it some kind of a demonic substance that is evil to consume or to even think about consuming. So he and I have had some interesting talks about that. And since his experience ranges into so many widely separated areas, I wanted to actually talk about the subject of free energy. And the reason I wanted to talk about that is that, you know, we're looking at solutions just, and he also is one that really likes to focus on solutions to things and not just saying how terrible everything is, you know, endlessly, but looking at, okay, well, if it's really that terrible, then what exactly can we do to make it not only less terrible, but actually good in the long run or as soon as possible? And I like that a lot about Ken's approach. So, the elements that we need our health back, we need the information that is true about how individuals can take charge of their own health and become almost completely independent of the medical system other than in accidents and emergencies. And the health system itself we need to change so that what it does do well, it doesn't have to use so many toxic materials in those procedures. But we also need the economy to be different. We need to get rid of the private corporation, mostly foreign-owned, that is given an exclusive license on counterfeiting in the U.S. And, oh, I'm sorry, I mean central banking, right? That's a term you may have heard more. But actually making money that's based on nothing, that just somebody printing it on their own computer or, you know, authorizing it based on the fact that they just feel like it, that's also known as counterfeiting. And when you have that in the hands of a single party controlling the monetary system in a whole country, no matter what kind of government you have, theoretically, you have tyranny or oligarchy, which means control by a specific group of a small group of people. And that's what we have not only in the U.S., but in almost all major countries around the world. And as you know, an example of what happens to a country who doesn't participate in that system, they turn into a bombed out mess like Libya. And that's one of the main reasons, if not the only major reason, that Libya had to be destroyed by Obama, Hillary, and their bosses and their minions and servants. And so the banking is a big deal. So we need the banking changed. We need agriculture changed. But we also need energy changed in the sense that the free energy sources and the clean energy sources that have been available for a very long time, certainly at least 100 years in recent history, this information, this technology needs to be open to the public. The government and its partner corporations need to stop killing the inventors and the people who try to market this type of technology, which they do commonly. Some of us have had direct experience with that. And we don't need the government to set aside this massive money, which they steal from the people and make believe they're diligently looking for better energy sources. They're already found. The discoveries are already made. And if the government will stop killing the inventors or intimidating them into hiding in silence, really that's all we need them to do, and that would not cost any money. They just have to stop some of their millions of different crimes that they're doing in this particular area. And if you remember, we had a show where there was a long talk by Stephen Greer that covered two of our programs, and he explained that they have the highest level government officials, many with clearance far above presidential level, which in many ways in the U.S. is figurehead level. And they were affirming that it's so far ahead of what the public is told in terms of what technology they already have mastered, some of it by reverse engineering, of course, but one way or another, they've got it in their hands now. They mastered gravity control in the 1950s. You understand what that means? We're flying around on these archaic airplanes burning up petroleum, which is ridiculous, polluting the air and moving very slowly and inefficiently and becoming conscious or unwitting vehicles for more chemtrail spraying, maybe by indirect control, because we know the spray turns on and off. So it's not just a constant emission from the jet fuel. That's not happening. Anyway, the technology for the jet airplanes and the cars and the trains and the communication means and things like that, they're not just archaic, they're way beyond archaic. And so that information needs to be released. Proliferating the free energy technologies and the clean energy technologies that Stephen Greer verified with, you know, very powerful backup has been available for a long time. That would go a long way to improve economic conditions as well. Because if you could use whatever amount of clean power that you wanted to do your own business and projects, some people have suggested that having free energy would be really bad because people would use too much of it and would pollute the world. And I totally don't agree with that. I think that if the clean energy were made available, the amount of reduced destruction of the ecosystem that would happen would be amazing. And even if people used a lot of energy, there would still be laws against, you know, or should be laws against using energy to construct things that damage everybody else's environment and that take away other people's rights, etc. Those laws are on the books now. They're just broken by government and by corporations, global corporations. But, you know, that's one of the things that has to be fixed. So having this free energy that already exists, and Stephen Greer's people have documented it extensively and are now working on projects to expose it, that would make a vast difference in the future of humanity. It's not the complete answer to the problems, but it would definitely help in so many ways that it would take a long time to go over them. You know, it would just be a massive change from the current energy and economic system that are designed to enslave us. They're absolutely designed. It's not an unforeseen side effect that they have. That's the design. These corporations that I mentioned that are called banks, as if they have all this, you know, solid money like gold or silver sitting in their vaults, which they don't. They issue money out of nothing. And I'm not just talking about the Federal Reserve. Even the local commercial banks in the various cities across the country, this is beyond the imagination of most normal people, but the truth is that they're allowed to lend money like on a home loan or a car loan or other things like that. They can lend money that they don't have, and then they can charge you interest on it. This is just, should be mind-boggling, unless you're just so used to this kind of crime that it's no big deal, and we need to not get into that state. So a bank in quotes, you know, just because they're called a bank, the word doesn't mean anything. What they actually do is what defines what they are. So these banks, the commercial banks that are under the control and protection of the foreign-owned Federal Reserve, which is a private company, they get to lend money to us that they don't own, that they don't have, that doesn't exist. And then they charge interest on that. Can you imagine what that does to the actual economy? and the money that you earn and how that decreases its value, etc. When you put money that doesn't exist into circulation, you correspondingly decrease the value of the money that's already out there. And this is a covert way of transferring actual wealth from the people that earn it and produce it into the hands of the people controlling these things called banks. And the word bank, it doesn't mean anything. The organization and what they're doing is what gives it its meaning. They're completely criminal organizations. And the people that work in the local banks are generally great, wonderful, very kind people. The ones I've met anyway, with very few exceptions. And they're chosen to put a good face on a ruthless criminal organization. And they do it very effectively. And they're not part of the scheme to do anything bad to us. It's the people at the top that do that. So when they lend that money to a government like the U.S. government and create unpayable debt, which they do, then they create control and slavery that goes with it. And anybody that really wants to understand that in a little bit more detail is advised to read a great book by G. Edward Griffin called The Creature from Jekyll Island. Many of you already know about it and have read it, but anybody that doesn't, I think you might find it very enlightening. And I've talked a lot with Ed Griffin, and he's done some really amazing contributions to the general understanding of banking, but so far nobody's figured out how to fix it. I mean, in theory they have, but not in practice. And it's the same with energy. And the energy corporations, they control oil and gas and nuclear and coal and things like that. And since the other energy, the much better free and clean energy sources, are suppressed, then we're left using this energy that gradually destroys the ecosystem and is very dirty and inefficient. It's not a great way to create energy, and nuclear is even worse because it has the capability of destroying the planet even in a limited disaster like happened in Fukushima, which is still doing massive damage, destroying the Pacific Ocean and things like that. So it's the government and its partner corporations that are keeping us tied to these ridiculous sources of inefficient energy. The government, and I'm not advocating anarchy in any sense of the word. I'm not convinced by the people who talk about anarchy that it's a good idea at all. Because with the present level of consciousness in humanity, there would quickly be private gangs that would do even as bad or worse than the government, and that's not a solution. But the government needs to be limited to protecting us from things like that, and protecting our individual rights as long as we live in a way that doesn't hurt everybody else or anybody else, intentionally. So there's a direct economic system needed based on earth resources, precious metals, organic agriculture system, which is a whole other discussion, and the energy technology needs to be disclosed. So that already exists. I mean, so let's go and see what Ken thinks of all this, and I'm sure the discussion will lead in many amazing directions that, since these things are spontaneous and unscripted, we're just going to let it go where it goes and see what happens, and I'll talk to you right after that with a couple of important things I want to add in. Thanks. Welcome, everybody. This is Richard Sachs, your host with Lost Arts Radio, broadcasting worldwide, and this is our show for Sunday, the 11th day of September 2016. And our guest and friend who's with us tonight is Ken Rohla, who's a returning guest on Lost Arts Radio. And Ken has a vast arsenal of different topics in his experiential background that he can talk about that are extremely interesting and beneficial for everybody to hear, very educational, which fits in with our theme of information. And the one that we're going to go into tonight, at least for our main initial focus, has to do with energy, because we've been getting a lot of people asking about clean and or free energy technologies. And the general understanding is that most of those aren't easily visible in society now because they're suppressed, or the inventors are killed or scared into hiding or things like that. I want to get an update on what is safe to talk about in that realm and just see where it leads us. So Welcome, Ken, and thank you for being here. I really appreciate the time.
Oh, my pleasure, Richard. It's always enjoyable to talk to you.
Yeah, it should be. This is basically just a nice, relaxed, unscripted, as usual, talk, sitting around in the living room, seeing what's interesting. So let's start with looking at where do we draw the line between what's safe to discuss and what's not?
Well, I think talking about free energy technology is pretty safe. It's actually making it that's kind of unsafe.
Right.
So we can talk about it.
As long as we don't use it to improve things in the world, we're doing
good. Exactly. The minute you start using it, even if you're just using it by yourself, mm-hmm. if the wrong people find out, it can be dangerous.
Okay. The opposite of life extension, basically.
Yeah. I've had experience with that because I've worked with people who've developed free energy technologies, and I was just at a conference a few weeks ago where there were multiple free energy technologies there, and just about every single one of them had stories of being attacked, in some cases really horribly so. One man had developed some technologies that he was forced by various government agencies to develop for them. And then when he was done developing it for them, they tried to kill him by injecting him with radioactive implants. And fortunately, he survived. But that's unfortunately very typical.
Yeah, well, they figured he was no longer needed, I guess, at that point.
Exactly.
So can you tell us since this conference was really recent in the field of advanced energy technologies, what can you tell us that's okay to talk about?
Well, there were some very interesting things at this conference. There was so much stuff there. Actually, it's hard to recall all of it, but it was for those people that are interested, it was the Extraordinary Technology Conference in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
And, when you go to the events like that, and they do, by the way, sell DVDs of the entire event for every year, so you can actually buy the DVDs. You can buy
individual ones. How do you find out where to get those if they're interested in seeing
their website is teslatech.info, TeslaTech.info.
Okay.
And, you can go there and buy them either individually or you can buy the whole set.
Okay.
And it was very, very interesting, a lot of really cutting-edge stuff. I would say probably the most cutting-edge information that I've seen on technology of all the conferences that I've been to, and so they have really far out stuff, and they have really brilliant people presenting that have the goods. They're not just talking and reading stuff off the internet. These are people that are making technologies and demonstrating them.
Okay.
Very often.
Okay.
And so there was a lot of amazing stuff. There was some of it I can't name names because some things I learned that were not presented on the public stage. And, it was like privately.
Yeah.
So, for example, a really simple way that people can generate free energy themselves in a small quantity. Actually, you could do it in a large quantity, too. You just have to kind of scale it up.
Mm-hmm.
But a practical application that anybody can do, anybody who's got just a little bit of mechanical inclination, I was shown a technology where you can actually buy an inductive heating plate or a hot plate from like Walmart or Target, places like this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember the brand name. Let me see if I can find it. Farberware. It was a Farberware inductive hot plate for like $40. You can buy them online. You can get them at places like Walmart. And if you, the way these things work normally is inductive hot plates and inductive stoves, rather than having a hot element that heats up and warms up the pot, they create strong electric fields, and then you have to have special pans and pots that pick up that inductive field and convert it into heat in the pot itself. And so it's heat through induction.
Is that a magnetic field that's actually being turned into electricity or just heat?
Well, both. It's converted from magnetism into electricity and then heat.
Okay.
And, but the burner itself doesn't get hot. The pot gets hot.
Huh.
So, it's called inductive heating. And it's very common. You can see stoves, these glass-top stoves that don't that don't get hot. That's what they're doing. But you can actually buy a portable one for, you know, like a little single burner hot plate for about $40 from Farberware that's an inductive hot plate. And rather than putting a special pot or pan on it, you can actually put a flat Tesla bifiler pancake coil on it, which you can make very simply. You can go online and just Google Tesla bifiler, that's B-I-F-I-L-A-R, pancake coil, and you'll see drawings for how to do this. But it's basically two spiral coils of wire that are, you know, start out at the center of a circle and spiral outward around themselves. And if you wire them correctly, they'll put out skater waves. And in the case of this application, if you put one of these coils on top of this inductive cooking plate, it will generate electricity out of the wires. And so you can connect the pancake coil up to a circuit or to a device and power it. And it will generate anywhere from 1.5 to 5 times over unity, as conventional physicists would call it. It's actually not over unity, because what it's doing is it's bringing scalar energy, which is this multidimensional energy, into the system through the pancake coil. So it's not creating any energy. It doesn't break any laws of physics. It may, according to conventional physics, a classical physicist wouldn't understand it. But it works. And the bottom line is anybody can do it, and you can put meters on it, and you can see there's X amount of electricity going in, and there's 1.5 to 5 times more electricity coming out.
Okay, so you need a couple of things. You need, first of all, that kind of magnetic induction hot plate, which is Tesla, and then you said buy something. What was that?
A Tesla bifiler pancake coil. So you can make these just out of plain old wire. It's a coil of wire on a flat surface. But if you Google it, you can see exactly how it's laid out. But you basically just take two wires and you wrap them, let's say, around a pencil. Let's say if you put a CD, a pencil through the middle of a CD, and so you've got a flat surface, and you take two wires and you wrap them around the pencil on the CD surface so that they're flat, and not, you know, bunching up on top of themselves.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And what you get is a bigger and bigger spiral of wire. And then you connect the ends in a certain way, and you've got yourself a Tesla pancake coil. And like I say, anybody can do this. Even if you know nothing about mechanics or physics, you can just go online and look at the way the coil is wired, which is very simple, and just do that with wire on some kind of a flat surface. It could be cardboard, it could be anything. And then kind of glue it up so that it'll stay, you know, all together. And then just lay that on the inductive heating pad and or hot plate, and it'll generate electricity coming out of the pancake coil. It's simple.
Wow.
Drop dead simple.
Okay. So if you got a bigger hot plate, essentially, which is not hot, but a magnetic plate, whatever it's called, mm-hmm. and you put a bigger coil of wire on it, could you power a house?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
That's exactly it. So, but you know, for about $40 and change, you can make your own little mini one and see that the principle works.
Okay. Okay.
And then, of course, you can upscale it if you understand how to build an inductive heating pad. And so, any electronics person could do it. You don't have to be an electrical engineer. It's like anybody who's got a little bit of electrical know-how or electronics know-how can do it. And you might even be able to buy them off the shelf. You probably can buy some larger field generators off the shelf and do it.
You need constant input to keep this thing going, though, right?
Correct. And as a demonstration, of course, you plug it into the wall, and you're going to get more energy out than what's going into it. If you wanted to be completely off the grid, then you solar power it.
I see. Off the grid. Okay.
So, and you know, so for example, in the case of solar, let's say you've got a solar powered house. Mm-hmm. Well, typically with the technology that's allowed on the market with solar, it's so poor that you have to have super insulated refrigerators and, you know, very small appliances and, you know, all sorts of, you have to make all sorts of compensations for the lack of real power. I mean, it's so expensive to do conventional solar, and the output relative to the expense is pretty poor.
And you're going down to 12 volt for everything, right?
Exactly, or 24 volt.
Okay.
And so, so you've got to make all these compensations and adjustments in your typically in your lifestyle and way of doing things using that type of a system, or else you've got to spend a boatload of money, which most people don't have. And so in this way, you could use a solar system and amplify the output of the electricity you're getting from the solar to five times of what you would normally get. Then you can run conventional appliances and things and not have to have all these ridiculous measures to run off a 24 volt system.
Would you not be on 24 volts anymore, or would you have that? But
no,
just
you could raise up to 120, and you can run it through an inverter and have AC power.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And just get rid of the inverter completely.
Yeah, it depends on how you want to do it. You can run it through an inverter, have AC power. You can run it DC. You know, it just depends on what you want to do. If you've already got a solar system, you can just make it more efficient and have more utility out of it by increasing the amount of output you're getting from your solar panels.
Okay, and the reason that this thing is able to be found, is that because they figure not very many people will really grasp it and use it?
Oh, nobody knows about it. I was told about it privately by somebody at the conference.
Oh,
there's nobody out like lecturing about it or anything.
Okay, yeah, that's what I wondered, because it doesn't seem like they would want that to be out there. There are things on the internet that are obviously not being suppressed that have, typically they have these long infomercial type presentations that are recorded that they get you to go to, and at the end they say, and this is going to save you 90% on your electricity, and you just have to pay for the plans of this special device, which only cost $100, and then everything's going to be wonderful. But I suspect because it's allowed out there, it probably doesn't work.
Well, that's true in many cases. I've seen a lot of free energy technologies that work in prototypes and in concept, but there's a huge difference between creating free energy on a benchtop and running a house off of it or running an appliance off of it. There's a big difference.
Right.
And then there's an even bigger difference to take it into production and sell it to people. And so, but I have seen quite a few legit free energy technologies on YouTube that I have witnessed in use, and I know they work. It's a kind of a matter of there's so much stuff coming out by so many people now that the powers that be can only squash the ones that are, the biggest threats. And those are typically the ones, they really aren't concerned with people who can't bring something to market.
Mm-hmm.
That, I mean, yes, they are concerned with people who have show plans and methods for developing and creating free energy if it can make a real dent in things. And open, if it can be open source and all that kind of stuff, then yes, those kinds of technologies very often will get stopped, but in most cases, that's not the case. In most cases I've seen of these free energy technologies, it takes a lot of time and effort to get it to where it can actually power, say, a vehicle or a house or something like that.
So do you feel like this one is different, that this is more easily scalable than a lot of them?
Yeah, that appears to be the case. I just learned about this a few weeks ago, so I haven't seen any bigger applications of it. But what it showed me was how simply the average person can create free energy in a very usable way. Because even if you didn't run your whole house on it, you could run your refrigerator on it.
Mm-hmm.
You could run your air conditioner on it. And so save yourself some money.
Yeah.
But there are certainly tons of people that have the expertise and knowledge that could take something like that and upscale it to run a whole house, no problem.
Right. Interesting.
And I know that it works because it was demonstrated to me right in front of me with meters and everything on it showing the input and output.
Oh, wow. Okay, so it's pretty easy to find these magnetic non-heating hot plates, right, if you just go to one of those big box stores like you were talking about.
Well, they don't carry them in stock. I've looked, at least in my area, they don't. But they do online, and you can get, for example, like Walmart and I think Amazon, they have, it's a Farberware, let's see, it's a Farberware Multifunctional Round Induction Cooker. That's exactly what it's called. Farberware Multifunctional Round Induction Cooker. And it's like $40 on Walmart, and I think $30 on eBay used. I mean, it's ridiculously cheap.
So you just put the pancake coil on that as if it were something that you're cooking, and
yes.
you have two ends of the wires coming out.
Yes.
And those are like, are those DC then?
Those are DC, but you can like say run them through an inverter and have AC.
Okay. All right, but for DC you could do a demo anyway.
Absolutely.
You know, hook it up to a light bulb or something.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, and then the amount of energy that you're taking from the wall, how would you measure that?
Very simply, with an ammeter. You know, you can get these multimeters from places like Home Depot that they have kind of a loop that goes around the cord, and it'll measure the current running through.
Okay.
So you can see, you know, real time what's coming through it, and then you do the same thing on the outputs.
Okay, and you're comparing amps to amps in that case?
Yeah, or you can compare voltage. You know, it's it depends on how much you understand about calculating amperage and voltage. But basically, if you look at equations for calculating amperage, voltage, and wattage, mm-hmm. you can use those and measure different things to see what's going on.
Okay, so if nothing else, right away you're proving that you're doing something that's not supposed to be possible, which is creating more energy than you're putting in.
Yes.
That's a big deal, because all the conventional education starts out to make sure that you know that that's totally impossible.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, you know, I went to electrical engineering school, and of course I was not taught any of this stuff. I mean, in fact, it doesn't. This kind of technology and this kind of energy, scalar waves and scalar energy, is not even acknowledged in conventional physics or engineering.
Right.
But it sure is in clandestine groups like the military and intelligence community. They sure as heck know about it and use it. And you know, people that are developing these things know about it. There are a lot of academics that know about it and talk about it. And, of course, they are ridiculed. Even extremely credentialed people, Nobel Prize winners, people with impeccable credentials who have been acknowledged by their own peers for decades to be brilliant, highly credentialed, respectable people. The moment they start talking about free energy, and, you know, free energy is a bit of a misnomer. It's not really free, but let's say, according to conventional physics, over unity technology, when they start talking about that, then all of a sudden they're lambasted by the orthodoxy.
And yeah, well, the net increase in voltage or amperes or watts would be free, essentially, right?
It's free from the standpoint that it's coming from a source that you don't have to pay for.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't mean it comes from not existing to existing, because it's just changing form.
And you know, it's like if you, let's say that free energy was allowed out on this planet, you would still have to pay for the technology to, you know, power your house or whatever, so it's not completely free. But once you've bought it, it could be running for decades, and you wouldn't be hooked up to a meter and being billed for it.
That's the idea of the solar systems that they're selling. It's just they're not so efficient, right?
Right. Yeah, not at all. I mean, there are really good efficient solar systems that could be a viable alternative energy system, but they're not allowed on the market. It's like anything out on the market right now, conventional, is not. It's a joke. It's like solar that's allowed on the market is a joke.
Yeah.
Compared to what it could be.
So,
I mean, the expense of it.
Do you think that the real technology that's available is like 50 years ahead, which you often hear, compared to what?
More than that, least 100 years ahead.
Okay.
I mean, you know, I mean, for example, water fuel technology, that's been around for 200 years at least.
You mean where you take the, where you split it into hydrogen and burn the hydrogen?
You split it you split the H2O into HHO, which is a different atomic structure or molecular structure of H. Instead of H2O, it's a different geometry of the atoms. And what you get is a gas that is a fourth phase of water. It's not steam. It's not liquid. It's not ice. It's a gas that burns, but it implodes, and it has a lot of really weird quantum properties. When you burn things with it, it interacts at the atomic level with the materials it's burning, so you can do a lot of really weird things with it, such as, of course, creating free energy, powering devices with it, but also you can, for example, weld any material to any material because it will alter them at the atomic level and then recombine them. You can neutralize radioactivity with it because, for the same thing, you can burn radioactive elements. And I've witnessed this done with a team of engineers and physicists and five Department of Energy officials and a couple of senators, U.S. senators. You know, having seen this done with Yul Brynn, mm-hmm. you take radioactive elements and you combine them with some other metals, I think it was iron and aluminum or something, and you burn them with this flame from this HHO gas, and because it reacts at the atomic level, what will happen is the radioactive elements will be altered at the atomic level and become non-radioactive. And I've seen that done more than one time.
So how would you do that on a big scale and a little problem like they have at Chernobyl or Fukushima or something like that, that you have to clean up a large mass instead of just a little bit that you'd put in a flame?
Well, it's conceptually pretty simple. You just create large brown gas generators that can put out large quantities of flame, and then you take the radioactive material and you combine it with these metals and burn them, and it becomes non-radioactive.
Okay, so I guess one of the first questions that would come up from the average person who's been taught what kind of thinking is reasonable is, okay, if there's all these amazing things and these problems are all unnecessary, how are they keeping that completely secret from everybody?
Well, they aren't keeping it completely secret from everybody because we're talking about it.
Yeah, that's right. We know about it. Sorry.
Well, they're not keeping it secret. They're just keeping it off the market.
Well, most people don't know it exists, I'm pretty sure.
Well, no. Out of 7 billion people, a tiny fraction know, but there are tons of people that know about it. I mean, there are at least hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people now that know about it. I would say millions of people now, thanks to the Internet and social media and stuff.
Okay, so why is it not for sale at Ace Hardware?
Well, because it threatens the entire economic paradigm on this planet. It threatens the energy production on this planet, which is highly controlled and centralized. Mm-hmm. It threatens, first of all, you have to understand that the physics in this stuff, when you understand the physics of how this works, which ultimately would come out if this technology was on the market, it implies far, far more than just free energy. It implies a completely different understanding of matter and energy that not only creates free energy, but and allows, first of all, you know, it allows individuals to create this technology because it's not so complex that a lot of mechanically inclined people can create this technology. So then that destroys the control mechanism on this planet. You can't control people through energy. And that's, by the way, just one application. You know, there are many, many other applications for this. You can use HHO for healing. You can use it for all kinds of stuff. But you're not just threatening the existing energy paradigm, which by itself is, I think, the second largest, not economy, but it's the second largest industry in the world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so so you're of course, threatening a gigantic economic paradigm, and also, I mean, you're threatening the economic paradigm of the planet, because if you release this stuff too quickly, it would create economic chaos, because our whole world economy is based so heavily on oil and nuclear and unsustainable technologies.
Well, now those are the reasons that they wouldn't want it out. But I was kind of asking,
those are a
few of the reasons. But okay, so given that there's plenty of reason from the people in charge not to want this change of paradigm and knowledge, how do they stop 7 billion people from producing it?
Well, you have to understand that to, for example, to create HHO, it takes a certain level of technological ability to create it. It's not like, you know, an auto mechanic's going to be able to create it. I mean, actually, an auto mechanic could, once the details of, like, specific designs were laid out. Probably an auto mechanic probably could. Mm-hmm. But the physics of understanding how to create it and then optimize it and then put it into a practical application, it takes a fair amount of expertise and money. And so the powers that be know they don't have to stop people from making this stuff, you know, in little quantities. They just don't want to allow anybody to bring it to market en masse.
Okay. Yeah, I had
that's
heard
all they
that,
have to worry about.
I had heard that there's some policy which is not publicly talked about in the United Nations that people who are daring to experiment on their own with this kind of stuff can be allowed to live, but the minute they start to try to talk about mass production, they have to go to prison for life, and that's if they're fortunate.
Well, that's what I have seen. That's been my experience. I've met people who have had free energy technologies, for example, you know, had water-powered cars riding them around, and they were fine. And then actually I've met some actually who just use it for themselves and were had it taken away from them and were threatened.
Okay.
So there's, you know, it depends. My understanding from, you know, working with people, scientists and inventors, is that it's only if upon examination of the inventor, if it appears that they actually can bring it to market, you know, if they have the wherewithal to bring it to market, that's when they start getting threatened. It's like, if you're talking about it and you're, even if you're just making it at your own house, but you can't manifest your way out of a brown paper bag, probably nobody's going to mess with you.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're, you know, making it public enough to where people who could bring it to market could utilize it, or, you know, if you have the wherewithal, or if you get to the point where you have the wherewithal to bring it to market, that's when you start getting visits.
Or maybe if you're a public figure, and, you know, if you talk about it one day, it would be a serious situation. They might foresee that and try to stop it, I would imagine.
Yeah, in some cases. It's like Marianne Cash, you know, he's got his, was it GDV, not GDV, I forget what he's calling his generator, but he's got a generator, and he's been open sourcing the plans for it, and people are making it. I've met some people that have made his generator, and it works. And they've been trying to kill him and shut him down, you know, many times. You know, you have to understand that within all of these power systems and organizations, there are lots of people in, you know, the military and in industry and in governments and et cetera, that they want this stuff out too. They don't like what's going on the planet.
Right.
They know that
right.
It's not sustainable. They know the way we're going, we're going to destroy the planet. So there are people who help people like Cash and others to keep them alive to, you know, so that eventually this stuff can come out. But from what I've seen in my experience, no one initially, I don't think, when it initially comes out, I think the only way it's going to come out is by doing exactly what Cash is doing, by giving it away for free.
So what's holding it up with Cash? Because I know that I've been seeing announcements for many months on the internet that before now the whole world system would be changed and all that, and I don't see that happened yet.
Well, I don't know Cash or anybody working in his organization personally, so I can't say personally, but I can say from experience working with Ewell Brown, because the same thing happened to Brown. Brown was going around filling stadiums of 50,000 people and showing them this device working and, you know, meters on it and everything, and he got stopped. And it was, and I was a distributor of his. I paid a bunch of money to be a distributor of his, and I kept waiting for it to come out. When's it going? And what was happening was he was being attacked constantly. He had several attempts on his life. His manufacturing facility was interfered with constantly, like faxes. Anytime he tried to send a fax to somebody or an email, it would get blocked and wouldn't go through. His FedEx and UPS shipments were getting lost constantly, you know, incoming and outgoing.
Okay.
It's just, you know, you can, when you have those kind of resources that governments have and big industries have, there are many ways that you can interfere with somebody doing regular business and bringing things to market. So I have no doubt that's what's going on with Cash.
How did it end up with Brown?
He was killed.
Oh, okay. I didn't know.
He was given cancer and killed.
Okay. Okay.
It was a very scary time, actually. I you know, I kind of went into hiding and kept my head real low for a few years because the people around him, a bunch of people had been killed and poisoned and hurt and attacked various ways. And, you know, it's like a very sad story. And that's, unfortunately, extremely common. You know, Stanley Meyer, same thing. In the 80s, Stanley Meyer came out with water fuel, and he was poisoned when he had signed, I think, a $30 million contract with the military to power all their vehicles with water.
Right.
You know, and so, and you see there, I mean, it's like the military was interested. They wanted the technology because they were not aware of this cabal that's trying to stop this stuff. And so they, you know, they wanted their equipment powered this way.
Okay, so, the contract that was offered to him was not a trick. It was legitimate, right?
I don't know for sure, but I know someone who worked very closely with Stanley Meyer who said that it was legit and that Meyer was legit and that everyone that worked with him, everyone that worked with him directly was poisoned.
Wow, I didn't know that. I thought it was just him.
No, it was a bunch of people got poisoned. And that's why, and the reason they did was so they wouldn't talk. And they don't.
Okay.
They don't talk publicly about it.
That's interesting. There'd be some logistical preparation to poisoning everybody because they don't all go to restaurants and things like
that. That's right, and it's expensive. I mean, to take a hit on someone, even by a government, it's expensive, you know.
Yeah.
But when you're talking about trillions of dollars that are at stake, it's peanut.
Well, and also if you've got a deal where the money you need can just be printed out of nothing, it's not
exactly
kind of deal.
Exactly.
Interesting. Okay, so right now the thing with Kesh is kind of in the intermediate stage where we don't know what's going to finally happen yet.
No, but my impression is that what's going to happen is that more and more people are going to be making his generator and just doing it and not participating. And this is what I've been telling people for many years to, you know, it's like if you don't like what's going on, don't participate in the paradigm that's being fed to you and sold to you.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to participate. You know, it's like there are various ways of getting out of the system. It's not easy. It's extremely difficult, typically, but it can be done. I've done it in various ways, and in a lot of cases, you're trading one kind of slavery for another. You know, it's like you get out of the system, and then you're always looking over your shoulder.
Yeah, well, it's like the people that are driving without driver's licenses because driver's licenses are fraudulent and illegal. But if you try to bring that up, a lot of people don't realize that and they might think you're bad, right?
Yeah, I had a friend, I lived in North Carolina, and I had a friend who, he was a state citizen. He got himself classified as a state citizen, and he was not required to use a driver's license because that was part of the Uniform Commercial Code and statutes, not constitutional law. And he rode around without a license plate. Well, of course, he got pulled all the time.
Yeah, and every 5 minutes.
Yeah. And what he wound up having to do was he had higher-ups in the Highway Patrol and the local law enforcement that were informed about the reality of the law, and they knew that it was legit. And so when he would get pulled, he would have to have the officer pulling him radio in to their headquarters to contact certain higher-ups that understood what was going on, and they would release him, but not without a bunch of hassle. So,
well, in their eyes, the danger would be if he'd explain it to everybody else. That couldn't be allowed, right?
Right, and at the local law enforcement level, nobody cares. They don't believe it. They just think that he's driving illegally.
Yeah.
But at the echelons that would care about it, that's exactly it. They don't want it spreading.
Yeah, yeah.
That's been my experience. You know, I mean, I've gotten out of the system in various ways in the past, and I wound up getting back in certain ways because, like I say, you're trading one form of slavery for another. You're always looking over your shoulder, or you're always having to research and figure out how to maintain your sovereignty.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to be willing to commit to that and put up with the inconveniences of it, which sometimes can be very great.
Yeah, you would have to basically give up most other parts of your life if you really want to fully do it.
It's true. I mean, most of the people I know, for example, people I've known that got out of the tax system, they did it legally and legitimately, but they were constantly having to stay one step ahead of the IRS because the moment that the IRS would find out about their tactic, they would do something, usually illegal, to stop it, and then they'd have to come up with a new tactic. You know, it's like, for example, you know, what's his name? There was a tax freedom. What's his name? I forget. But anyway, there was a tax freedom proponent who was teaching thousands of people how to get off the tax rolls, and it was legit. It worked. And the IRS, he would, every Thursday, he had a radio program, and he would call up the IRS's attorneys and ask them to confirm, you know, what his position was. And, of course, they got tired of that really quick.
Yeah.
And so they ultimately, they couldn't, for like 30 years, they couldn't beat the guy. But finally, they just said, heck with it, we're throwing you in jail. They had no legal grounds to do it, but they just threw him in jail. And that's what happens when you become an enemy of the state.
Yeah, it reminds me of, you know, the, when you're studying for your driver's license in most states, if there's a four-way stop sign, the person on the right supposedly has the right of way. It's more or less universal. So it's like, if you're stopped at the stop sign and you're the furthest to the right, and there's a truck coming across from the other side that does not have the right of way, and you go because you're right and you get run over, it's not necessarily good for you.
Exactly. Exactly. And that's what, you know, when I meet people nowadays who want to get out of the tax system, and I tell them, it's like, and they'll be telling me all the legal reasons why, you know, it'll work.
Uh-huh.
And but the one thing that they always miss is that I say, well, you're basing all this on rule of law, correct?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
But the IRS does not operate lawfully. They're illegal as hell. They break all kinds of laws constantly. They don't even know, you know, like one agent doesn't know the law, you know, that another agent knows. And
right.
If you call up and ask them, you never get the same answer from, you know, two representatives twice.
And they'll tell you that it's okay if they give you the wrong answer. They have no responsibility to make sure that it's accurate when
exactly.
you call.
That's it. But, I mean, I've seen that over and over again. Even the best untaxers have been thrown in jail. Irwin Schiff, he was the one. He was the one that would call people.
Okay.
He would call the IRS up, you know,
yeah.
every Thursday and talk to their lawyers and confirm, you know, that he wasn't required to pay taxes.
Yeah.
And that nobody was.
Yeah, he didn't end up well. I mean, he died
in
the hospital handcuffed to the bed with police around him.
Yeah.
And he was really old, and he couldn't.
Yeah, and he's not the only one. You know,
right.
And these guys were successful for decades.
Yeah.
Eddie Kane here in Florida, you know, same thing happened to him. He was successful for decades, and then one day they just came and arrested him, threw him in jail, and, you know, no lawful grounds to do it.
Yeah.
But
what,
and then
was Eddie Kane telling people how to get out of traffic tickets and stuff, too?
Yeah, all kinds of stuff. And it was, you know, it worked. It was legit. According to the rule of law, it was legit. But, you know, after a while, they locked him up, threw away the key, and that's what, you know, I've seen over and over again, is that these organizations, they don't act lawfully. The only way you can really get rule of law is if you have the money to defend yourself. And in the case of Eddie Kane and people like him, I've known other people like that, they don't just throw you in jail and then, you know, it's Perry Mason. Oh, no. They throw you in jail, and then they bounce you from jail to jail to jail all across the country so that your legal counsel can never find you and your family can't find you, and you have no support system whatsoever. And then they seize your bank accounts, and they bankrupt you so you have no money to defend yourself, even if you're rich.
Right, right. And they can actually, now, they can take anybody's assets by charging the assets as doing the crime and not you.
Right,
you
just label it as terrorism.
Civil asset forfeiture, right?
Yeah.
They say, well, we found cocaine on the money because there's cocaine on all money, and therefore we're taking all your assets, but you can protest if you want to.
Yeah, and like I say, you know, these days with the Patriot Act, all you've got to do is throw the word terrorism at you, and then, you know,
national
everything
security.
You're doing, it's like, oh, then rule of law doesn't apply because you're a terrorist.
Exactly.
You go to Guantanamo or whatever. It's like,
and in fact, you know, what was one of the really interesting things in the Aaron Russo interview that Alex Jones did, which I thought was great, was he was talking about when he met one of the Rockefellers, and it happened to be Nick Rockefeller. And he's saying, you know, basically acknowledging everything that you're saying, but offering Aaron, who he thought had potential, to join the insiders. And when you do that, instead of getting harassed to death like you've just been detailing, they give you an ID, And this was supposedly a card that said KMA on it. And if anybody stops you for anything on the road, you show them that. And that's the end of it. And they salute you or whatever they do. And all you have to do is, you know, give up all sense of morality and sell your soul. But you have a really great life and you're, you know, part of the ruling elite after that. And you don't worry about these little rule of law details.
Right, right. I mean, most people... quite honestly, most people in the world are mind controlled, and they are being fed, having a reality crafted for them and being fed to them through mainstream media, and they buy into it.
Yeah.
You know, there was a study at Princeton a couple years ago by Professor Martin Gillens and Professor Benjamin Page that stated that the U.S. is no longer a democracy; it's an oligarchy, and it's run by corporations. It's a corporatocracy, but the corporations, of course, are run by very, very wealthy families,
right?
And very small groups of people. And you know, the average American still believes they're free, rah rah, and all that kind of stuff. I mean, just look at the elections. You know, I mean, most people are dissatisfied with both candidates, but most people still believe they have a choice. Either going to be Trump or Hillary, you know, and it's like, it doesn't matter who gets elected. If there was a green grasshopper running for the election, they're not in charge. The president
that
is not in charge
problem.
Of the country.
Right, right. They
but
appear, they appear
they
to be when they're in harmony with those who are in charge.
Right. And so, you know, so most people are being fed this fantasy of what's going on, and most of them buy into it.
Mm-hmm.
More and more people are not buying into it, but they don't know, they don't understand to the extent that their reality is being crafted for them. It's just mind-boggling. I mean,
yeah.
It's so mind-boggling, quite honestly, I don't talk about it a lot because people won't believe it.
Yeah, that's the main camouflage that I've seen that keeps most of the truth out of reach of people, is that it's so bizarre that a normal person would just immediately assume it's ridiculous and it couldn't possibly be real.
Precisely. And part of the reason that they believe that is because they've been programmed to believe that through movies and television and media, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, you know, lots and lots of disinformation on the internet. So people are very much, their unconscious minds have been programmed. And so they have these knee-jerk reactions to information because they've been programmed that way.
Yeah,
people
I mean,
don't even know about.
Even
that.
With all the programming on the television, you know, the question would be, one question would be, what percentage of the actual programming that's going into your brain while you're watching TV is visible or audible? I bet the vast majority of it is subliminal.
Yeah, very true. Very true, especially with smart TVs and digital. Signals and all that now. Matter of fact, at the Tesla Tech Conference, that was one of the things that a man named Bob Boyd had presented, and he was sequestered by the government to develop technologies, take technologies that he had developed and develop them for them. And he did a presentation showing the hardware in cell phones for spying on you. And obviously, of course, you know, people have heard that your microphone and your camera can spy on you, that, you know, different apps can turn them on and off whenever they want. For example, the Facebook app, when, you know, one of the things that you agree to in using Facebook is that it can spy on you, basically, and turn your camera on and off. And lots of other apps can do this, right? Well, a lot of people have heard about that, but how many people have heard that cell phones have skater wave technology built into them that can spy on you even when your phone is turned off and even when your phone is inside of a Faraday cage, which is a metal box? You know, nobody knows about that.
Yeah, well, we just had Barry Troer on, who's one of the world authorities in microwave weaponry and technology, and as far as I can tell, he's not aware of that. He said that you can put your cell phone at night inside a metal box like a Faraday cage, and that would, you know, keep it unable to spy on you, but that's completely wrong according to what you're saying.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I believe too, until you know, I met Bob Boyd and talked to him, and I mean, he did this, it was a public presentation, and it's on the Tesla Tech website. If you buy the DVD of him, Bob Boyd, he shows the hardware, you know. It's like, and I said to him, I'm like, well, God, you know, if you got a cell phone, like, you know, where are you going to put it where it's not spying on you? He said, leave it out in your car.
You think that would be safer, actually?
Yeah, because I would guess at that distance, and again, this is just a guess. I know nothing about the actual technology other than what he shared, so I don't know how strong it is, but I would suspect that, you know, that it's not powerful enough, you know, especially if you put it inside of a metal box, that it would go that far. But you never know, because skater waves are really weird. They're interdimensional, and they don't propagate like regular waves, so it very well could.
Well, the other thing that I always wonder about, besides all the incredible surveillance of the cell phones, especially the so-called smartphones, is that it's not an unavoidable side effect of communications technology that it has to give you brain tumors. I think these things can be designed so they're actually good for you if they wanted to, right?
Oh, absolutely. There's a German company, and unfortunately I don't remember the name of them, and I've looked for them after I originally came across them and haven't been able to find them again, but there is a German company a few years ago I saw, that is working on a skater wave cell phone. And even a conventional cell phone, if you were using the right frequencies, would be far, far less damaging. But with a skater wave cell phone of the right frequencies, it could actually heal you.
Right, that's what I was thinking. I mean, Barry Troer said the frequency of the cell phone is set to be the same as what they would use in weaponized microwaves.
Precisely. When you look at the frequencies, it's like, why did they choose this frequency? It wasn't because it's the optimal frequency for communication technology. I mean, cell technology is crappy. It's really crappy.
Yeah. So when Tesla was talking about his free energy tower that would send it out wirelessly and everybody would have free electricity, which made Mr. Westinghouse upset, I think, with no meters, could that wireless provision of electrical power have been done without the health detriment and other problems of the current cell technology?
Oh, absolutely, because Tesla understood skater technology. Of course, at the time, you know, it wasn't called that. That's just the latest buzzword for this superluminal light energy.
Yeah.
But absolutely, Tesla understood this, and that's why he wanted to do it, because the Earth is a giant capacitor, and you can use its field in a lot of interesting ways, including, you know, broadcasting power wirelessly and communications and things like that. He understood that. And so, yeah, he developed those technologies. He wanted to help humanity and free us. And, you know, the powers that be absolutely did not want that. And
so he's one more guy like Stanley Meyer that just got shut down as soon as they knew what he was doing.
Exactly. Yeah, he was one of the originals, I would say.
Yeah. Okay, well, you know, going back to the idea that government and its partner global corporations, which are really indistinguishable from government at this point, are, as you say, maybe 100 years ahead in technology than what they let the peasants like us hear about or certainly have access to. Let's get into an area that will convince everybody absolutely that we're completely insane. And just leave the most devoted listeners.
That won't be much of a stretch in my case.
both of the listeners who are left can hear about what's coming. So what I was thinking is the idea of reverse engineering, which are, you know, we had a previous show with Stephen Greer on, and he is not the average UFO wacko, because he talked to hundreds of people in the government above the clearance level of president, and there are many levels above president, who in many ways is a figurehead, and people don't know that. And he talked to them and got them to risk their lives and go on video, all confirm each other that there were crashes or, you know, many, many cases of scalar waves being used to shoot down you know, benign and friendly craft from other places or other dimensions even, and that the technology was taken out of the wreckage, and a lot of things like, you know, fiber optic cable being a simple example, were reverse engineered out of the wreckage. And so I'm assuming that you're pretty familiar with that stuff, and let's go into the extent of what came out of those things.
Well, There's been a ton of disclosure coming out from people who have worked in these military contracting companies, aerospace companies, and high technology companies that were tasked with reverse engineering some of these spacecraft that were found. And, you know, these are people that are very well credentialed and very well respected. And as you mentioned, you know, Stephen Greer has brought out a ton of them. Mm-hmm. I mean, dozens and dozens. And, you know, these are people that have unquestionable credentials. You know, they're high-ranking military officers, colonel rank and above. You've got Paul Hellyer, the former Minister of Defense of Canada, who has come out and said not only have all these various countries had extraterrestrial contact, not UFO contact, but extraterrestrial contact, he also says there are two extraterrestrials that he knows of working in the U.S. Pentagon. So when you've got, you know, these highly placed people coming out and saying this stuff, and from many different countries and many different walks of life, some from the military, some from the military contractors, some from government, and some just, you know, Joe Schmoes like me. I mean, I've encountered extraterrestrials myself, and I've talked about it in interviews. So when you've got this huge body of people coming out and talking about this stuff, and then you compare the common threads between them, particularly with people who've come out at different times in, you know, in our history, then you have to look at that and you know, say, it's like, okay, even if there was a giant conspiracy where all these people were somehow being told to come out and, you know, and create a hoax, there's still too much that can be confirmed to say that it's all a hoax.
Mm-hmm.
And then, aside from that, it seems that lately there's been just a slew of whistleblowers, again, highly credentialed whistleblowers who have come out and they're exposing all this stuff. And there's a man named Michael Salla, Dr. Michael Salla, S-A-L-L-A, for those folks that want to check him out. I think his website is exopolitics.org.
That's Alfred Weber, too, isn't it? Or are they working together or something?
They probably are, but I've been reading books that Michael Salla has written and also been listening to a lot of these people coming out with disclosure information, because I've seen a lot of people disclosing, you know, alleged information about extraterrestrial contact and UFO stuff. Mm-hmm. And because I've had interaction with some extraterrestrials, you know, in the physical, usually I can tell if they're lying or not, because there are common threads of what they're saying. And what I'm seeing is that there's a large degree of these whistleblowers who have corroborating information that I've encountered personally.
Right.
So I can tell, like, a lot of these whistleblowers. For example, William Tompkins. There's a man named William Tompkins who has come out recently. He's done interviews on Gaia TV, and he's got YouTube videos. And he reports to be a spacecraft designer who worked for TRW, and he worked for the Department of Defense and the Navy, developing spacecraft carriers that looked like something straight out of Star Wars. I mean, there were these big triangular ships that looked like they were straight out of Star Wars. They could carry hundreds of smaller anti-gravity flying saucers. And these are all like high-tech anti-gravity time-traveling craft. These are because when you're doing superluminal flight, you're not propelling an object through space. You're actually dimension-shifting, let's say, the spacecraft. See, the problem is our understanding of matter and energy is fundamentally flawed, and so to say that it's dimension shifting isn't really accurate. It's more like frequency. It's more like dialing through a radio dial,
yeah,
shifting your frequency and showing up somewhere else.
Remember, even in the movie Dune, that was suggested because they were talking about these almost instantaneous technologies allowing you to move between distant points, and they called it folding space.
Right, and there's been many other people, you know, calling it folding space or wormholes or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I think part of the reason why so much of this stuff has been in science fiction. Some of it may have been intentional disclosure, you know, like a drip campaign of gradual disclosure. And I think a lot of it probably, I know in some cases, like I've heard some of these insiders have said, like, for example, William Tompkins said that some of this information was actually fed to people like George Lucas and Steven Spielberg, so that when they, you know, created their movies, they had accurate representations of, you know, these ideas, because it was part of a very gradual disclosure campaign. Because even the negative powers that be on this planet understand that the way we're going right now is not sustainable. Mm-hmm. Their solution is not to create sustainable, uplifting realities for us. It's to get rid of us.
Yeah, exactly right.
You know, well, remove the load on the planet by getting rid of it.
What I actually came to recently is that, you know, people say, well, that's ridiculous, because if they wanted to, they could kill us right away. But they don't. What they don't realize is that what they are emulating or worshiping or focusing on requires a ritualistic sacrifice of something which happens to be us and the planet.
Well, it also, I think, when you look at how the universe operates at a fundamental level of consciousness, we have to agree to our own extermination, for one thing, I believe.
Yeah.
But even if you, you know, skip that, if you just look at killing off 7 billion people, logistically, that is not an easy task. It's not easy to wipe out, you know, because you can't, like, encircle the Earth in a big plastic tent and fumigate them like you would, termites in a house.
No, but you could fire all the nuclear weapons right now.
Well, but the problem with that is it would destroy the Earth itself, and the powers that be don't want to destroy the Earth. They just want to get rid of us.
I think they want to be in a position where they're pretty much what they think is going to happen, which I don't think is accurate. But they, at the top level, they really believe that they're going to get to a point of merging with the computers and entering cyberspace, and it won't matter if the Earth is destroyed at that point.
Well, you know, and I don't know what's in these people's heads, and I'm sure there's a huge variety of viewpoints even amongst these ruling elite.
Mm-hmm.
But my impression is, particularly with these people who are interested in transhumanism, where you integrate technology with human biology, that I think part of what's going on, based on my experience with extraterrestrials, is that there's artificial intelligence. There's a, how should I explain it? There are places in the universe where artificial intelligence and machines operate in a reality of their own, where they are sentient and they are self-aware and all of that, but they do not have the spark of life that organic beings have, and they actually need us sort of to create them and evolve them before they can come into being. And as a part of that reality, they use artificial intelligence in various ways to infect us, or at least some of us, in order to further their reality and their agendas and their goals.
Yeah.
So I think these people who are interested in transhumanism, I think part of what's going on with them, the reason that they idealize this mixture of technology and human biology, is because they have been infected with AI themselves.
Oh, that's interesting.
Mm-hmm. And that's so far out. I mean, I know that sounds like cray cray. I know that. I understand that. You know, I get that. But I've had experiences. There's a wonderful line in the movie Blade Runner where Rutger Hauer's character says, "I've seen things you people wouldn't believe."
Mm-hmm.
And that's been my experience. I mean, I've seen things most people would not believe.
Right.
And so based on my experience, particularly, you know, with not just with encountering extraterrestrials, but also encountering really advanced scientists and inventors and technologies, my impression is that part of what's going on, there are many facets to this. I mean, it's not as simple as just that AI has infected these people, or let's say extraterrestrial AI. But it's many things. You know, part of why people value transhumanism is because they're very, very disconnected from their own emotions. They're very disconnected from nature, and quite honestly, they're in need of healing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
You know, but it's kind of like, you know, why sociopaths and psychopaths rise to power. It's because when you don't have any scruples, or compunction, you know, you can do all kinds of unscrupulous things and get a lot of negative things accomplished.
It gives you a funny kind of advantage, right? If you're
it does, because you don't worry about hurting people. And I mean, you know, I have a next door neighbor who's like that. I see it manifest all the time with this guy. It's like he does all this really horrible stuff, you know, to people on the planet.
Yeah.
Through his very business and various things, and it's because he has no compunction about hurting people.
I just had this picture in my mind that we'd do a show kind of like a Jerry Springer, you know, takeoff, and ask him to call in and go through all this stuff. But we won't be doing that because it's pre-recorded.
So, you know, it's complex as to why we see the conditions that we see on this planet. But when you start to understand, there's a much bigger influence here. There's an extraterrestrial influence on this planet. You know, for example, I was speaking in Philadelphia a few months ago at a conference, and Dwight D. Eisenhower's great-granddaughter, Laura Eisenhower, was speaking there.
Right.
And she was saying, you know, that Eisenhower, I think he had been, he had encountered five different extraterrestrial races and had been on some of their ships and stuff and had communications with them and stuff. As part of their interaction with our military and other militaries.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the reasons why he warned about the rise of the military-industrial complex, you know, in his parting farewell speech when he was leaving office. You know, he did this famous speech where he warned about the rise of the military-industrial complex. Well, what he understood and what he knew about was these alliances between these extraterrestrials and our military, and not just our military, but also this corporate conglomerate that was evolving out of the defense contractors who were developing all this and reverse engineering all this really advanced technology for our military. And so what's happened, according to people like Corey Good and others, is that these defense contractors wound up developing so much technological power and financial power that they became more powerful as a collective than governments. And
yes.
So part of the reason why you see the madness that you see within our own government is partially because of that. It's because there is this extra governmental influence on our planet that has more power than governments themselves. And
mm-hmm.
you know, so we think, oh, well, you know, the heads of the military, why would they allow this? Or why would the head of the CIA, you know, or why would the president? Well, you have to understand they're not at the top of the food chain anymore.
No, they're not even allowed to get into the information.
Precisely.
I mean, they're just hung up on when they try to find out.
Precisely, yeah. You know, according to various insiders, William Colby, the former CIA director, was killed because he found out about the secret space program and all this ET contact stuff, and he wanted read into it. And because these organizations are not governmental, they won't let people in who have scruples and want to bring it out to the public.
Yeah, it would ruin everything.
Which is what Colby wanted to do. He was very much a patriot, reportedly, and, you know, wanted the best for the world and for our country.
Mm-hmm.
And so, therefore, those kinds of people with, you know, high values, they don't get access to these programs and information.
Yeah. So you have warnings from people like Eisenhower and actually Kennedy gave a talk about secret societies and things shortly before he was killed.
Correct.
But the problem is, even when people hear about that, the talk does not include instructions for what people should do to get over it.
Well, because I think they understand, you know, that if they give too much explicit information, they'll be killed.
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, since you've had Stephen Greer on your show, I'm sure you've seen him talk about the story about what really happened with Kennedy. Supposedly, you know, Kennedy and Jack Kennedy and Bobby Kennedy supposedly were having an affair with Marilyn Monroe.
Mm-hmm.
And when it became too public, they decided to cut it off, and Marilyn Monroe was incensed over it. And he had told her all these secrets about this, you know, this ET contact that the government was having. Supposedly Kennedy had been on ET ships and things. And she was going to spill the beans because she was mad at him.
Yeah,
dumping her, and didn't want that to happen. And so she threatened him over the phone to release everything that she knew to the public, and within like 3 days she was dead.
Uh-huh.
And then he was incensed that, you know, according to Stephen Greer, I think it was Vannevar Bush who ordered her execution.
Mm-hmm.
And then when Kennedy, you know, he became livid over that, and, you know, he publicly stated he was going to splinter the CIA into 1,000 pieces and all this stuff. And then, you know, he was killed, and then Bobby was killed. And, I worked with Martin Luther King's family and found out some interesting things about Bobby Kennedy's assassination, and not necessarily through them. Some things were confirmed by them, but basically my understanding is that part of the reason why Bobby was assassinated was because he was going to run for president in 68, and Martin Luther King was going to be his vice presidential running mate.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
I think they would have won.
I mean,
if they announced the real vote totals, they would have won.
Yeah, exactly. But King also was planning a million-man march across the country where he was going to march across the entire country collecting poor people and bring them to the mall in Washington, D.C., and have a million people protesting, you know, war and economic policies and those kinds of things.
Yeah.
And reportedly, the U.S. government and J. Edgar Hoover, for example, were terrified that King could actually overthrow the government. And so they assassinated him in April of 68, and I think Bobby was in June of 68.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there may be other reasons, but, you know, those were some of the reasons involved. So, you know, increasingly what's happening is that as people that were involved in these things age, and they're getting up in their 80s and 90s now, and they're on their deathbeds in some cases, they're coming out and telling the stories of what really happened. And there's, you know, in some cases they've got a lot of evidence showing it. Like William Tompkins, you know, he's 94 years old now, and he's still involved in the secret space program. And he's got documents to show it. He's got government documents. He's got drawings of spacecraft that he designed and all kinds of stuff. And he gives details, for example, in the Apollo space program, how it was, he claims that there were several Nordic extraterrestrials, as he calls them, who worked in his organization and others that were posing as secretaries and miners, but they were guiding and directing them in the Apollo space program to get it developed. And supposedly this Apollo program was supposed to be three phases over 30 years where we go to the moon, we build bases on the moon, and then we go to Mars from there. But the reason that didn't happen, supposedly, according to Tompkins and some other folks, is because when they got up there, there were already extraterrestrial bases up there, and they didn't want us there. And so they told us, take a few rocks, take some pictures, and go back home and don't come back. And that's supposedly why the Apollo program ended, according to Tom.
What about the stories about bases existing on the backside of the moon? Have you heard about that?
Absolutely, yeah, because, I mean, Corey Good has been coming out with this. William Tompkins has come out with it. Michael Sala documents it extremely well in his books. It's hard for people to really wrap their heads around this unless you read the details that Michael Sala, for example, details in his books. But according to what whistleblowers, you know, are coming forward with through these various sources, reportedly in the early 1900s, there was an elite secret society that was started by an Austrian baron who created the Thule Society in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And part of their interest was to, they were already involved in a lot of esoteric occult kind of work and knowledge, and apparently they got interested in searching the globe for extraterrestrial technology, and they did. They sent people out on expeditions looking all across the globe for ET technology. They found it. And they also found extremely advanced humans living inside the Earth with extremely advanced technology who were posing as extraterrestrials. And basically they got some of this technology in various ways, started engineering, working on anti-gravity flying saucers and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, there was a woman named Maria Orszak who was channeling all this extraterrestrial stuff about how to build anti-gravity flying saucers. And when the Thule Society found out about her, they created another society called the Vril Society, because the Thule Society was mainly concerned with advancement of the physical realms, you know, control on the planet and having a breakaway civilization in the physical sense. The Vril Society was created by them to advance the esoteric and the spiritual aspect of reality. And so Maria Orsic was channeling all this really esoteric stuff involving extraterrestrials and anti-gravity and all kinds of things.
Mm-hmm.
And so she wound up developing or channeling all of this information on how to build anti-gravity flying saucers, along with several other women who were very intuitive and psychic. And then, I guess, at some point in the 20s or 30s, the Nazis found out about it. And they sequestered her and had her working on projects for them. And then people like Victor Schauberger, who had developed anti-gravity and technology and free energy technology, the Nazis forcibly sequestered him to develop these technologies. So by the time World War II ended, they had developed a few, like two or three anti-gravity flying saucers that they ran off to Antarctica with and created bases down there. Actually, according to Michael Sala, they started this well before the war was over because they could see how the war was going. And there were actually several different factions that were, you know, working on this stuff. So it's a long and interesting story, but basically the whole history of what we've been told is not true. You know, we're told that, you know, the United States and the Allies won World War II, mm-hmm. and we did win, you know, the public battle. But the Nazis wound up developing their advanced technologies in Antarctica and South America, and then their interest was going off-planet, developing off-planet civilizations, but they needed the United States manufacturing base to do it with. And so essentially what they did was blackmail the United States into doing that by using their advanced technology against us to show that they had superiority.
So is this connected to the stories that come back about nobody being allowed to enter most of Antarctica, and there also is no official development of the vast mineral resources down there for some publicly unknown reason?
I mean, according to these whistleblowers coming out sharing this stuff, particularly Corey Good, who, you know, what I've seen him talk about, I believe that he's telling the truth because of my own personal experiences with extraterrestrials. I think that I haven't seen anything that he said that contradicts what I've seen personally. And normally when there's somebody out there BSing their way, it becomes obvious really fast to me that they're, you know, they're faking it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's telling the truth. And he's saying that, and there are other people saying this, that the Earth is a giant honeycomb in the Earth's crust. It's a giant honeycomb of caverns, giant caverns, and places, you know, some with water, some with oxygen, mm-hmm. and air, and that there are people living inside the Earth that have been there for millions of years that went underground millions of years ago when the Earth was going through various cataclysms, you know, with, I don't know, comets or whatever hitting the Earth,
right.
And so they had to go underground, and because they're so ancient that they've developed very advanced technologies like anti-gravity and time travel and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And there are lots of stories, not just from these whistleblowers, about this as well. You know, there are various Native American cultures, for example, that talk about the ant people that live underground that gave them information and knowledge and stuff. And
mm-hmm.
The Navajo have similar stories, and others. You know, and then there's stories. I got a friend here in town who's been to Mount Shasta who said that I believe that she encountered some beings when she went into some place at Mount Shasta and saw some kind of a being there. So, you know, and when you look at Mount Shasta is a volcanic mountain, and volcanoes, the way that they're created, they generate these very, very large lava tubes that can be used, you know. I mean, they're big enough to you know, be a dwelling.
Mm-hmm. You mean when the hot material goes away, it leaves an expanded place in the rock that's a cavern?
Yeah, what happens is the lava starts hardening up, some of it hardens up and some of it's still flowing. And so the stuff that's still flowing flows through these tubes, and eventually hollow tubes are left when the lava flows out. And so you've got this honeycomb of lava tubes. I mean, this is very common in geology. Conventional geologists know about this. And so these tubes are gigantic. I mean, they can be, you know, hundreds of feet in diameter and miles long. And supposedly some of these are entrances to some of these underground dwellings. And, you know, and I know this all sounds far-fetched and crazy to anybody who's not heard these stories before, but, you know, I was told this stuff 25 years ago by some reptilian ETs, and, you know, at the time, I didn't believe it. I didn't believe any of this stuff. You know, I was questioning the whole reality of what I was experiencing, encountering these reptilians. But what's boggling my mind now is that stuff that these ETs told me 25 years ago, now there are all these whistleblowers coming out and saying it. So I know that... You know, I mean, you know, why would these ETs tell me this stuff 25 years ago, and now all of a sudden these, you know, all these military contractors and people, like all these folks Stephen Greer are digging up, they're saying the same stuff.
Yeah, it's getting almost impossible to keep, you know, making any case that this stuff is all crazy, and I think that it's just threatening psychologically to humans until they get a certain deep base of stability that allows them to explore things without being threatened. That, you know, it's a normalcy bias, what they talk about in psychology, that you want to reject ideas that threaten your whole understanding of reality. But it's kind of a funny thing that we consider people from other places that we don't know about to be aliens because, you know, they could consider us to be aliens just as well. It's all life forms, including us.
Well, that's very true, and, you know, it shatters your whole worldview when you think, for example, you know, like 30 years ago, you know, I was a computer programmer working a straight job and, you know, had the house and car and all that kind of stuff and, you know, and just had a nice, simple life, and I was totally happy with that. And, you know, then I encountered these freaking reptilians, and it totally shattered it. And I was terrified for a few years. I was terrified that I was going to be abducted. And, you know, my wife is, you know, having to deal with this as well. And thank God she was very open-minded. But, I mean, you know, it's like when you have these experiences that are so far outside of the average person's reality, you know, it sounds crazy. And I understand that because even when people tell me they've had encounters with extraterrestrials, my first thought is, I wonder if these people are MK Ultra mind control.
Yeah, or how many drugs they're on and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But so since, you know, since that. Most people, other than a lizard and a snake, don't really know what a reptilian is at this point, you probably should explain what you just said.
All right. Well, and I've talked about this on quite a few occasions on other programs, but basically, my entire life, I've had a lot of information that you know comes into me telepathically. And you know, when I was younger, in my very early years, in my teens and my 20s, I never ever for a moment thought that this information and ideas that would just come out of the blue to me, I just thought it was coming from me. I just thought it was in my head and that was it, you know. And I never
imagination
thought about it coming from thought about it coming from some other source. I just thought, you know, everybody experienced this kind of stuff. I just thought it was ideas popping in. I never even questioned where it came from. I didn't think it was coming from anywhere external. And when I was in my early 20s, I read the book Seth Speaks, which is channeled information from a lady named Jane Roberts. It's phenomenal material. And when I was given the book, actually at a party, by a guy, and I got home and I started reading it, and I couldn't put it down. It was so not just enthralling, but there was all of this information in this book that I had always believed in my life since I was a little child, and yet nobody around me believed it. And just about the nature of reality and stuff. And so I was like, I couldn't put it down. I was just like, this is amazing. There's somebody else in this world that believes the same stuff. And so, you know, later on, I started thinking about, well, if this lady's channeling this stuff and it's coming from this other entity somewhere else, I wonder if some of this information that's coming to me is coming from somewhere else. And so as I started contemplating that and starting asking, you know, this voice that would sometimes give me information, you know, who are you and where are you from and all that kind of stuff. And what I was told was that it was extraterrestrials, and that that there was a collective, a small collective of ETs that were working with a lot of different people on the planet to share information with them to help improve the planet. Well, you know, I was in engineering school. I was very left-brain, logical-minded, and I didn't buy it. I thought, well, if this is true and I'm not just crazy and talking to myself in my head, then I've got to meet you physically. And they refused to do that. They said that human DNA has been programmed to fear the reptilians because of manipulation of our DNA for various reasons, but mainly to keep us subdued and controlled and disempowered, particularly psychically disempowered, because when all of our DNA is plugged in, then we are very, very powerful creators. We're already very powerful creators. You know, consciousness creates reality, and that we can get into that if we have time, but mm-hmm. but there's actually, you know, a mechanism for that. But when you get that consciousness creates reality, then because consciousness is scalar energy, and scalar energy can alter and create matter, then we're extremely powerful. And particularly when what scientists call our junk DNA, what I was told by these reptilians is that the junk DNA is actually modules of DNA that have been unplugged by the reptilian master geneticist that manipulated our species to keep us controlled. It's a long, long story behind all this. But at any rate, so they, you know, they refused to meet me in the physical because they said it would traumatize you too much and it would thwart the work that we want to do with you. And at the time, you know, I'm like in engineering school and then later, you know, in the corporate world as a computer programmer. And I'm thinking, this had nothing to do with my reality.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, you know, I'm just doing the 9-to-5 job thing. And so I didn't understand what they were talking about. But they would, telepathically, they would give me information. Sometimes it was words. Sometimes it was pictures and video and, you know, various ways. And they showed me things that had absolutely nothing to do with my, you know, my world at the time.
Mm-hmm.
It was interesting, but it's like, well, you know, why are you showing me this stuff? But so I kept insisting. It's like, well, if I'm not just crazy, then I've got to meet you in the physical. And so so I pressed for about 2 years and pressed and pressed. And finally, they did show themselves, and I had a witness with me. I was actually at a party at a farm in North Carolina, and there was a guy at the party who I was in computer science. He was in computer science, and he wanted to. He was going to go to a bunch of Baltic states and countries where I guess you'd say the world management wanted to set up foreign exchange systems and currency systems and basically financial control systems of all these countries in the Baltic region and Russian satellites and that kind of stuff. So this guy's trying to talk me into it, and I knew nothing about any of this, you know, Illuminati stuff or, you know, any kind of conspiracy stuff. I was just a white-bred white guy from North Carolina, mm-hmm. you know, programming computers. And this guy's trying to talk me into working on these computer systems, and I didn't want to do it, not because of, you know, any ethical reasons for putting in these control systems in these countries. I just didn't want to work with the crappy technology that they were working with. And because I was in a job where I was working with state-of-the-art stuff, it was really cool, and I loved it. So the guy, in order to try and talk me into it, he says, well, let's go down to this spring and meditate, and let's meditate on it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have to understand, I mean, there's a long kind of backstory behind this, but basically this farm, there had been a lot of events there that were kind of like little mini Burning Man events. It was basically a bunch of kind of eclectic people and hippies that would get together and have get-togethers and party and have a good time and get out in nature and camp out and just enjoy each other's company.
Right.
And And a lady named Barbara Marciniak would come and channel sometimes, and really interesting stuff. And the guy that owned the farm wanted to dig this spring out and make a swimming hole for everybody.
Okay.
And so they got the bright idea of digging it out, and they, you know, so people would come and camp out, and we would party and dig this spring out and have a good time. And they had to do something with the mud they were digging out of the spring. And so, you know, hippies being hippies, they decided to build a serpent mound like Native Americans used to do. And so they started piling the mud up, and, you know, first it started out really small, but eventually they dug this spring out into a pretty big hole, and they had a 65-foot-long serpent mound that looked like a Chinese dragon. They had sculpted the head and everything, and they had built this wiggling, you know, serpent mound about 65 feet long and about 4 feet wide, maybe 3.5 feet tall,
mm-hmm.
and it was quite large. And what they really did was, at the time, none of us knew about anything about this, but we basically created a giant piece of orgonite, for those that are familiar with orgonite. Mm-hmm. Orgonite is a material where you mix metal particles and minerals and crystals, particularly volcanic minerals and crystals, into a non-conducting substrate like resin, and it generates skater waves. And skater waves can be used for various things, including healing, clearing chemtrails, protecting against EMF, a whole slew of things. And it also, if you build a big enough device, it'll create a vortex that'll kind of make a, like a, let's say, an interdimensional portal. So basically what they did was they dug out this spring and created this portal, this vortex of skater waves. And the water, the spring water that was coming up out of the spring water, part of what brings it to the surface is not hydrostatic pressure. It's actually levitation, because the water has superconducting minerals in it. It's kind of a long story, but basically bacteria in soil eat minerals, certain minerals, that become monoatomic. They become like individual atoms of these minerals. And in this form, they become anti-gravitational. But the soil locks them down into the ground, and they can't levitate out. And then rainwater washes these minerals down into the aquifers, and when they've accumulated enough, they levitate up through the aquifers to the surface, and that's what brings spring water up to the surface.
Mm-hmm.
So they're very high in superconductivity, and the best way to get them into the body is topically.
Let me interject a question there before I forget. If that's how the spring water is coming up, you know, from against gravity up to the surface without necessarily having pressure from, you know, coming down from a mountain and being trapped there waiting to come up just by siphoning, then could that same principle be used if there's a decent shallow aquifer to create a spring and make it come out of the ground?
Oh, absolutely. Not only that, there's a Russian physicist who's proven that you can actually bring spring water up through the ground by building pyramids. Because pyramids are skater wave antennas. It's kind of complicated, but basically we've got skater energy coming down from the cosmos through our atmosphere and from our sun and other suns, and then also from the center of the Earth. And when you build a pyramid, you create an antenna that takes that energy and concentrates it in a local field. And anything that's anti-gravitational, it's going to pull it stronger away from the center of the Earth. And so when you've got spring water in these aquifers, it's got these anti-gravitational minerals in them, and then you build a pyramid in the area, it'll pull that water more strongly, and what happens is you start seeing springs pop up in places where it didn't exist before.
Okay.
And that's exactly what Alexander Golod in Russia, a Russian physicist, has proven time and time again. And not
with
just
his
water, but also oil wells and stuff.
He's the one that's got the big pyramid near Moscow?
Exactly. He's got a 144-foot-tall pyramid made out of wood and fiberglass outside of Moscow, and this is one of the things that they observed with it.
Okay.
Springs started popping up from miles around that used to not be there. So anyway, so I'm invited to go meditate about this job
mm-hmm.
with this guy. We go down to the spring, and the serpent mound is coming up out of the spring, you know, so the tail of the serpent's coming up out and wiggles along the ground. These are in some woods in a valley. And so we are dangling our feet in this water. And like I said, one of the best ways to get these superconducting elements in the body is topically.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get these elements in, they're very regenerative and healing, but they also plug into the acupuncture meridians of the body and the brain neural pathways and the DNA, and they raise the superconductivity in these areas. And when you raise the superconductivity, you're increasing the strength of the mind-body connection, because this is where the mind interfaces with the physical structures of the body.
So it's not just really efficient grounding that makes you feel so great when you go out in the forest into a natural stream or something. Your skin is absorbing some of these elements at the same time.
Well, it's absorbing them if you're in water that has these formless elements, or if you're, you know, exposing yourself to soil or something that has them in it.
Okay.
And there are a lot of different reasons why you feel good out in nature, many reasons.
Yeah. Most of them not conscious at this point, I think.
Right. Okay. So anyway, we're sitting there, you know, meditating with our legs dangling in this spring, and as often was the case, these ETs started speaking to me telepathically, and when they would come in, they would always say, "We are here." And I said, "Okay, well, what do you want?" And they start talking to me a little bit. And so I said to the guy sitting next to me, I said, "You're not going to believe this, but I got reptilian extraterrestrials talking to me in my head." And to my surprise, he says, "Yeah, they're talking to me too." I'm like, "What?" And so we just sat there quietly. And so, you know, I said to them, "Well, you know, what do you want?" And ultimately they said, "Well, we are here." And I said, "Yeah, I know you're here, but what do you want?" They said, "No, we're here physically. Open your eyes." And so both my friend and I open our eyes up, and this is in a valley, and it's at dusk, and so it's fairly dimly lit, and there's trees all around. And about 50 yards away, there's these three gigantic reptilian beings standing. And, you know, at first, my first thought is, you got to be kidding me. This is like something straight out of Hollywood, because they look so stereotypical Hollywood. They were tall. The small one was probably 12 feet high, and the large one was probably about 18 feet high. I mean, they were as big as my house. Mm-hmm. And they were slender, but they were muscular, and they had olive drab skin, you know, like army green skin.
Mm-hmm.
They had scales all over. They had no clothing. They had no genitals that I could see. They had claws, you know, their fingernails and toenails were like claws.
Mm-hmm.
They had three ridges going down their head, across their skull, one going down the right side, one going down the left side, and one going down the middle. And, you know, I'm looking at this, trying to grok this, and I'm thinking, "You got to be kidding me! Somebody's messing with me, because this just looks too Star Trek." And so, you know, I start smacking myself in the face and doing triple takes, and they wouldn't go away. And I said to my friend, "Like, are you seeing what I'm seeing?" And he's like, "Yeah, I'm seeing three gigantic, you know, reptilian thingies." And so we were just in shock, you know, and I'm trying to figure out, is this like a holographic projection? Is somebody screwing with me? You know, what is this? And after about 2 minutes, when I finally realized, and, you know, while we're standing there looking at them, they're communicating telepathically simultaneously to us both, which we found out later.
Okay.
And after about 2 minutes, I realized this is real, or at least I thought it was real, and I got absolutely terrified, and I said, "Let's get the hell out of here." And we ran back to the party, and neither one of us wanted to talk about it. We talked about it with each other, but we didn't talk about it to anybody else because, you know, back in those days especially, I was an introvert. I was a computer programmer. I didn't want people thinking I was crazy, so I was like, "I'm not talking about this crap."
Did you know if it was real. Were you clear about what exactly it was that was scary at the time?
No, it was totally instinctual.
Okay.
It was totally instinctual. And, you know, my friend felt the same way. And so, you know, later that night when I got home and I went to bed, they came in and started communicating telepathically again. And they said, "Well, we told you, you know, your DNA has been programmed to fear us." And I said, "You're right. I don't ever want to see you again. I believe you. Just leave me the hell alone." And so And they didn't, of course. They kept communicating with me, and they gave me a lot of really valuable information over the years. And the most valuable stuff was actually just how to be a human being. You know, like the importance, particularly for men, the importance of feeling, and, mm-hmm. and feeling and trusting your feelings and developing your intuition, and you know how to operate on a day-to-day basis in relationships, and the importance of doing emotional healing work and physical detoxing and stuff like that. And you know, they taught me what they called energy exercises, which later I found out many years later, like 20 years later, that what they were teaching me was things like Kundalini Kriya Yoga and stuff mm-hmm. that, right. you know, very advanced beings use. So it was pretty mind-blowing. But then, you know, I had to integrate it, and along the way I was still getting all these downloads of information about stuff like, you know, that ETs use monoatomic gold for time travel and space travel because it remains the same through different dimensions of time and space, or just, you know, just bizarre stuff that had nothing to do with my world.
Mm-hmm.
But it was interesting, and so I just kind of, you know, put up with it. And then, but I came to trust them very deeply, because what I saw consistently over and over again was that all the information that they gave me was very empowering. None of it was asking me to be dependent on them or anybody else. It was yeah. all about finding my own answers and figuring things out for myself, and basically staying out of fear and having an uplifting life, and you know, all that.
Yeah, kind of it stuff. Sounds really good. What do you think their motivation was?
To teach me the fundamentals of stuff that I needed to know to do what I'm doing now.
Well, why? Example, I mean, why did they want you to be able to do that?
Well, according to them, it was an agreement that I had with them and other beings. You have to understand that, you know, our concept, like when you say an extraterrestrial, what we're really talking about is an interdimensional being. And they even told me that part of the reason that they were able to teach me things about how to be human was because they were human beings in other realities simultaneously, because mm-hmm. time and space are not the way we think of them. Time is not a continuum, like it's not a series of events. That's just our perception of it. Everything's existing simultaneously.
Right.
And these particular reptilians were working with other ETs like Pleiadians that had evolved to the point where they understood the bigger picture of things, and they understood their multidimensionality. And so they understood that they were different types of beings in different worlds and times and places throughout the galaxy. Mm-hmm. And so they understood how to tap into that. And so their goal in working with me was supposedly a pre-agreement before I was born into this world to, you know, to do certain things. But my perception of it was not that I had any duty to help humanity or anything like that. I just wanted to have a good time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just want to have a good life, have a good time, have some laughs, you know, have a little party here and there and that kind of stuff. And what I discovered, though, was that, you know, when you do the work, when you do the spiritual work and you do the emotional healing work and you do the physical detoxification and you heal your body up and things like that, you have a hell of a lot more fun in life.
Yeah, yeah. You know? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, giving up things that you think you're completely dependent on instead of making you deprived gets you to enjoy things you never imagined before.
Exactly. And when you understand that you rule your destiny, I mean, you don't fear death and those kinds of things, then nobody can squash you. Nobody can sequester you, even if they kill you. It's kind of like Obi-Wan Kenobi in Star
right.
Wars. Like, strike me down, I'm going to be more powerful.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so it's just a lot of really cool lessons like that over many years that I developed trust, and I haven't seen anything conniving or manipulative in that process over the years.
So the fear that you were programmed with when you met them physically wasn't based on any malice on their part or any bad intent toward.
No, they didn't do anything at all to make me afraid except being there.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's one thing to talk about it, but man, if you're standing, you know, in front of some freaking 18-foot tall reptilian humanoids,
yeah,
it doesn't matter what you think. You know, it's easy. Oh, I'm a badass. I wouldn't bother me one bit. I'd go up and kick their ass. No, that's not how it is.
No, I think the fear depends on the state of of consciousness at the time. Because if you get to the point where you're more aware of yourself as an unlimited being, it gets really hard to scare you with anything.
Precisely. I mean, it wouldn't frighten me at all now. Yeah. The truth is, now I wouldn't need that. I've had so many bizarre experiences over the years of various kinds that I don't need proof that these beings really exist. And I also have gotten to the point where I understand, too, that they're not simple extraterrestrials as we think of extraterrestrials. They're multidimensional beings. I don't think they need spacecraft to travel.
Yeah. I think that's a very rudimentary level that does.
Yeah. And so, and they talk about that kind of stuff. So, and it's, you know, for somebody who has not had these kinds of experiences, it's difficult to relate to this, and it sounds crazy as heck, and I get that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that in my nature, I cannot not tell the truth about my experience. I used to care what people think, and I used to keep it to myself, and I didn't talk about it. And it doesn't benefit you to talk about this stuff publicly. You know, it's been very detrimental to my business and to relationships because it's, you know, fortunately because of all this disclosure that's coming out, it's sounding less crazy now to talk about this stuff. But, you know, years ago, it's like prominent people would not interview me or do business with me because I talked about this stuff, even though privately they would acknowledge they believed it. But they didn't want to be associated with it.
Right. I guess they're just worried about how they look to other people.
Precisely, and they understand that it would hurt their business, you know, in the case of business relationships. And I do understand it, because like I say, you know, even now when people will come up to me sometimes and tell me they have an ET contact, and I start talking to them, but the first thing I'm thinking is, are these people MK Ultra mind controlled? Because I have encountered people that will do that, and I've encountered a bunch of MK Ultra folks who will come around pumping me for information and spying on me and stuff, and you know, wanting to get information on things that I've done or people I've worked with or whatever. And so that, I think that's part of the reason why these reptilians taught me to learn discernment and to learn to trust my feelings and to be able to read people and that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, that little term, you know, of what you feel, there's a vast amount hidden behind that word.
Right.
Because you can develop your feeling ability to access levels that your mind is not going to be doing for a while.
Very true, because when you're accessing your feelings, part of what you're accessing is the vibrational frequency. Well, what feelings are and what human consciousness is scalar energy, which really is God consciousness. It's kind of like we're part of this giant galactic circuit, and ultimately there's this intelligent, loving energy coming from the center of galaxies that we call God, you know, it's whatever that is.
Yeah.
And we're a part of that circuit. And so when you're trusting your feelings, when you're feeling things, you're tuning into the vibrational frequency of that scalar energy flowing through you.
Right.
And when you're in proximity or thinking about anything, then you're either going to resonate with it or you don't. And in the case of something that could be harmful or detrimental to you, it's really not going to resonate with you. It's going to feel bad. And so if you trust those feelings, then you'll always navigate well.
Yeah. I think that's why animals have so much better judgment than people in a lot of cases, and so much faster, is because they're tuned into the feeling level.
Yeah, yeah. And we have been intentionally misdirected away from that. We've been taught to live in our left brain and to deduce everything logically, and there's certainly a need for that. But you have to balance logical deduction and hierarchical thinking with empathy and feeling and intuition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
When you do that, you know, you become extremely powerful. And you know, most of the people that are labeled geniuses on this planet, that's really what they're doing. They're just able to balance the left and right brain, the emotional and the intuitive, with the logical and the hierarchical.
Right. So everybody ultimately waiting for them kind of has access to this vast input of knowledge, information, and guidance. if they get the blocks out of the way, so they start picking it up consciously, right?
Correct. Yeah, in my experience, that's correct.
So the issue of how to get rid of the blocks is probably the automatic question once you understand what all that means.
It's healing and dealing.
Mm-hmm.
When you heal yourself, you heal your issues. What happens is, all healing really is reinterpretation of your experience. You know, whether it's physical or emotional, but especially if it's emotional or.
So what does that mean? Maybe you should explain that for people.
Well, when you, for example, I was born hypoglycemic. I was born with gland issues, blood sugar issues. I was kind of like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. If I didn't get enough sleep or enough food, you know, I'd have blood sugar swings, and I could become very emotional or very short-tempered and that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so I go to, you know, I worked in the medical system, so I go to the, quote, wellness program that our company provided, and which was going to hospitals and doctors, and they all said, you know, well, you need this drug, or you need this, whatever it was that they were peddling, that's what
mm-hmm.
I needed.
Right.
And, you know, if I didn't trust my intuition and just went with what they said, I would have been led down a path of drugs and therapy and psychiatry and misery,
yeah.
You know, for the rest of my life. And then and then most likely my life would end prematurely.
Cutting edge medical science, in other words.
Right.
Yeah.
And so fortunately, because of these encounters, not just with these reptilians, but also with human beings who taught me about healing and stuff. For example, I was apprenticing with a potter. I was learning how to make pottery. I was apprenticing with a guy who discovered wheatgrass juice and started drinking it and juicing it and swimming in it and bathing in it,
mm-hmm.
putting it in his eyes, putting it in every orifice of his body, doing enemas with it and crazy stuff.
Yeah.
And the guy had amazing health improvements. And so, you know, having encounters like that, had I not been open to healing and dealing with my situation and dismissed it and went down the medical path because I didn't trust my feelings, then I would suffer along the whole way and die prematurely.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is the importance of trusting our feelings and seeking out, actually knowing the difference between shit and shinola, knowing the difference between what somebody's telling you and what the truth is.
Yeah, we've been trained to check that by looking it up in a journal somewhere.
Right, because we've been conditioned to live in the left brain, to live in the logical mind, and to trust that, and to only act on empirical data. And you can't always do that. Empirical data is fantastic, it's great, and we need it. But you can't rely on that solely, and always.
Right.
So you've got to balance that. And so that's what I mean by healing and dealing. It's like, you've got to seek out, because everybody on this planet these days, because our planet is so toxic, from everything from 2,000-plus nuclear detonations and Fukushima and Chernobyl and pesticides and herbicides and genetically engineered food, genetically engineered microbes, biowarfare agents, geoengineering pollutants, all this crap that we're breathing in and consuming. Everyone on this planet is toxic unless they are detoxing on a daily basis. And so if you don't heal and detox, heal physically, heal emotionally, heal mentally, then you will suffer immensely and you'll die prematurely.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what's going on. You know, the vast majority of Americans.
Yeah, we're told it's normal.
Right. They're on pharmaceuticals, they're depressed, they're unhappy, they're overweight, they're sick, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They're dumbed
right.
down,
right.
you know, and they don't know what the solution is. And they don't even seek the solution in most cases. And so that's why it's important, it's extremely important to heal and deal. But that's why healing is reinterpreting your reality. Had I not reinterpreted the reality that was being presented to me, I would have never figured out the path of healing.
Hmm. Okay, so I'm still a little bit unclear what you reinterpreted it to mean. What is that?
Well, for example, I grew up, had a lot of trauma in my early life, and, you know, according to conventional wisdom and what society would have us believe, you know, it'd be very easy to be in victimhood about that and blame, and for the rest of my life, blame the people and, you know, blame and be in victimhood and never come out of that and never grow or expand or heal or feel better or be happy, you know, be healthy, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And so part of what I had to do was reinterpret what I had been taught about that, reinterpret what I had been taught about the medical system and drugs and all that kind of stuff as not being a solution for these kinds of things.
Right.
You know, I was immersed in the medical system from very early age because my mother was a nurse, a career nurse, like 40, 50 years. She actually was the nurse that delivered the first Salk polio vaccine.
Wow.
And so I was heavily immersed in that mentality. You know, the medical system, and especially back in the 60s, you know, doctors were always right.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
And back in those days, quite honestly, they could be trusted more than they can be trusted now.
Yeah.
But had I not reinterpreted everything that I was being presented with, then I would have bought into it and suffered immensely. So that's why, you know, healing is reinterpreting your past. It's reinterpreting your experience and then expanding beyond it.
So now that a lot of the people are challenged by the fact that just as real life is not a single variable experiment that you can look up in a journal and get anything that is accurate, if somebody in general wants to start upgrading their life to the point where they're aware of the next level of things that are going to teach them their lessons, sometimes it's overwhelming because they have so many things that are confusing. I mean, on the emotional level and on the physical level about, you know, what they're eating and what they're doing and how they're dealing with the outside pollution situation and the money situation. All these things create sometimes overwhelmingly confusing stress. So,
well, it only is overwhelming because you plug into it and buy into it. For example, one of the things that I teach in my workshops is one of the first things you do is you stop watching TV in whatever form, whether it's Netflix or Amazon Video or regular network TV or whatever. Stop plugging into that crap. Stop watching it, because anything you expose your unconscious mind to, it programs it with.
Yeah. Yeah.
It doesn't know right or wrong or good or bad. It just knows if you're watching murder and betrayal and death and misery and darkness and hopelessness, et cetera, then that's all your mind knows. If you're exposing yourself to uplifting situations, loving people, color, light, beauty, uplifting situations, and empowerment, which is very hard to come by online.
Yeah.
Now, there are not many people out there. I mean, there are a very, very small group of people on this planet who are teaching how to be, you know, for example, financially successful, to be abundant in whatever way or shape you interpret that to be happy, you know. And it's not being blind to the dark stuff. It's being completely aware of the dark stuff and understanding your own power so that the dark stuff does not make you feel hopeless or depressed or disempowered.
Yeah, you're just kind of strategically aware of it, right? So that you can make better decisions and that sort
of thing. Right. And, you know, and that process is not easy. I've had my worldview shattered a bunch of times, and I was depressed and fearful and everything for months or years sometimes. But ultimately, I had to pay the rent, you know, and I had to go to work. And so I had to get past it. And so I did, and that's what we have to do. Is, you know, fortunately, there are more and more teachers now showing the way how to do that.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, giving up television is a huge step. It's like getting off one of the major drug addictions. And
oh, yeah.
I know in the entertainment sitcoms and everything now, from all that I get told about them, they're portraying people as more helpless and confused than ever. So that your brain subconsciously assumes that's how you are, and you're not going to be able to make any progress without having experts control your life. And that's
right. And that's it. And you model it. You know, you model what behavior you're around.
Yeah.
If you were around high vibrational people who were extremely uplifting and extremely successful in every way, not just financially, but they were happy, they were healthy, they were motivated, they loved life. You surround yourself with those kinds of people, and you're sitting around talking about, you know, oh, did you see what was on Game of Thrones last night? And they'd be like, I don't even know what the fuck Game of Thrones is. That's the kind of reality I encounter sometimes. It's like I encounter people that are like that in the area where I live. And I, quite honestly, I don't hang out with many people in my area because of that. I'm in the second poorest county in Florida. There's a lot of poverty consciousness. There's a lot of limitation consciousness. And so I don't want to be around people like that.
Yeah.
So I find a few people around who are motivated and uplifted and happy, et cetera, et cetera, and I hang out with them. Fortunately, like, you know, Dr. Joe Mercola is one of the people in this area,
mm-hmm.
and he's an amazing, amazing man, and I get to hang out with him from time to time.
Yeah.
And it uplifts me, you know?
Yeah, a lot of personal growth teachers recommend that as a therapy every day is to start consciously choosing who you're around, and if in your work or something else you have to be around people that have a negative influence on you, don't open yourself up to it, even if you're physically there.
Precisely. You know, many people, you know, including some of my staff, they don't get when I say, well, I don't know what this program or that program is. No, I've never seen that movie. I don't know about this. It's because...
Right.
And you know, you're talking to somebody who back when I was a kid was a TV addict. I mean, I watched mm-hmm. hours and hours and hours of TV every week.
Yeah, me too.
But now it's like, it's not a part of my reality. I don't even know, like when people are on Facebook or whatever referring to, you know, whatever latest Pavlovian trigger has been presented to them through the media,
mm-hmm.
I don't know about it. I don't know what it means. It's like when they were talking about Brexit, you know, everybody's like, Brexit, Brexit, Brexit. I'm like, what the hell is Brexit? Because I don't watch the mainstream media. I have never been want for information that I needed, particularly important stuff. I have never, you know, been like, ooh, I'm out of the loop because I wasn't plugged in. No, it's like I'm actually much more plugged into the loop because I know what's really going on that really matters, whether it's a tornado or a hurricane coming or, you know, what foreign policy is going on across the world. And usually because of the kinds of information sources I plug into, which is myself, then I can see what's really going on as opposed to what's being told in the mainstream media or whatever.
Yeah, I think one of the subliminal messages is, unless you have external inputs, you don't know anything.
Right, right.
Right, and those are all coming from television experts, education, science, you know, the whole system that you're supposed
Correct.
To just
and
pick
particularly
up.
These days, that's exactly opposite of what's true. Because when you understand that just about everything that you're presented, especially through the mainstream media, I mean, you can pretty much be guaranteed in the mainstream media that everything you're being presented is a lie.
It's gotten to the point with government agencies and things that it's really sometimes a valuable source of guidance, because if you just take the message and reverse it, it's often valuable.
Precisely. When the few times that I get exposed to, say, like television, when I'm in airports, for example, it really, really grates on my nerves just to hear it.
Right, yeah.
But I figure, well, if I'm here and I can't get away from it, I'm going to look at it and see what's being presented to people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's quite interesting to see, particularly when you understand neuro-linguistic programming and mind control techniques and triggers and things like that, it's really, really interesting to see this stuff, because I have a completely different interpretation of what's going on than an unconscious person watching it who's being programmed.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, you can actually see the hypnosis process happening pretty continuously.
Correct. And also, you know, like movies. I pretty much stopped going and watching movies because Hollywood has been so co-opted now for mind control programming.
Yeah.
It's like in very subtle ways that people, it blows my mind that people don't notice. For example, like all of the logos of all the movie companies now, they're all black.
Uh-huh.
You go watch a movie. I was watching an old movie. What was it? It was like an old Doris Day movie, and
yeah.
It was beautiful Technicolor.
Oh yeah, I remember that too.
You know, and it was just beautiful movie, very, vibrant colors, well lit, uplifting. The Paramount logo, when it came on at the beginning of the movie, was, you know, this beautiful colored mountain with blue skies.
It was really inspiring.
Right?
I remember 20th right. Century Fox and all the music they played at the beginning of movies. It was yeah. In
it's
fact,
cheerful.
Even a lot of the plots in the movies were about some really wonderful value or something like that.
Well, and back then you had to have a well-written plot if you were going to have a decent movie, because you didn't have all the special effects and things you have now.
Right.
You know, too many movies nowadays rely on these whiz-bang special effects. For example, like all the new Star Trek movies that J.J. Abrams has cranked out, they're all pathetic, in my viewpoint, having grown up with Star Trek.
Yeah, compared
because
to
Star
the
Trek
real.
Wasn't about whiz-bang special effects, it was about the human condition, and that's what's being left out of that series.
It pretty
now.
Much now always degenerates into everybody killing each other, and
right, exactly.
whoever can kill
simple.
Each other faster is the best person.
Exactly. But when you go to watch a movie from the very get-go, the first thing that comes up after the previews is the logo of the movie company, and they're all black. It's all depressing.
Yeah,
and all the movies bear, the lighting is subdued in them. It's very rare that you see bright colors in movies anymore.
Wow.
You see acid-washed movies where the whole movie has a color cast over it that's gray.
Oh.
And it's designed to hit the unconscious mind and make people feel hopeless and depressed and disempowered.
Wow, I guess I haven't been to movies for a long time. I didn't realize.
I don't remember the last one I went and saw. I just stopped going to movies because it's just the same fodder over and over and over again. And it's so blatantly obvious when you understand mind control. If you study trauma-based mind control and you study neuro-linguistic programming, that's all these movies are.
It's really interesting, too, about the helplessness programming because, you know, they're doing interesting combinations of programs. Like they tell everybody on mainstream television that society is endangered because people have access to firearms, and that's why everything is terrible. And then in the movies, everybody who's anybody good is shooting everybody else.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of contradictory messages that I think are meant to short-circuit your brain.
Oh, absolutely, without question. And it's part of mind control processes. You know, and that's it. I mean, when I was a kid growing up in North Carolina, you know, kids would bring their guns to school, and I mean, they'd leave them out of their car, but, you know, this was a hunting culture.
It didn't matter. It was irrelevant.
Right. You know, I mean, my friends were into hunting, and I would go hunting with them sometimes, and they would bring their rifles to school, leave them in their cars, their trucks, and show them to their other buddies, and like, look what I got, man, and they'd go deer hunting or whatever.
And they weren't all,
shot
they
anybody.
Weren't all going crazy and shooting everybody.
Right.
That required Prozac and
mind control. The level of trauma-based mind control was not so pervasive back then.
No. In fact, I remember in the 50s, as a really young kid in the single-digit ages, walking a few miles to the community pool by myself as like a six-year-old, and it was fine. Nobody did anything bad.
Oh, yeah. We would go trick-or-treating for miles. We'd be out trick-or-treating 3-4 hours.
Yeah.
And no one was worried about anything, but that's it. There was mind control programming going on, but it was nowhere near the level that it is today.
No, the general atmosphere felt like it didn't have those thoughts in it.
No, it didn't. Not especially not the degree and the quantity and the messages, no, for sure not.
Right.
The tragedy for a lot of young people is that they have nothing to compare with. You know, it's like, I remember what it was like years ago. And even most people my age don't remember because they've been so sick and their brains don't work well. They can't even remember hardly their own address. And they definitely don't remember something
exactly.
40 years ago.
Exactly. And in a way, all the problems are from getting disconnected from any experience of what normal is.
Right. Right. And that's part of the program that we have to get back to, is being connected to nature. Part of the process of healing and reinterpreting is getting back to what's real, getting back into nature.
Yeah.
Especially, nature is the program that heals us. You know, I was sitting in a park yesterday, and this is over in Orlando, and I'm sitting on this park bench, and I'm reading a book, and just enjoying the day, and there's these two little kids that keep walking back and forth past me. back and forth. And then after about four or five times of this, I looked up to see what the heck was going on, and of course, they're playing Pokemon Go on their cell phone.
Oh my God, okay.
And they're trying to find something, and I'm thinking, you know,
oh geez,
what are these guys looking for? You know, what's showing up on their phone? And I'm thinking, you know, so I call the guys over, and I say, hey guys, you playing Pokemon Go? They're like, yeah. And I said, well, let me tell you a few stories about that. And I totally blew their minds. They probably thought of some Looney Tunes, but
yeah.
But, you know, they heard it.
Right.
They can't unhear it now.
Right, right.
So,
I mean, one thing you really notice now, not only is the atmosphere changed in most places, but people are getting more and more lost in electronics. I mean,
absolutely.
Like, not just at the gym where they wear headphones and you can't talk to anybody anymore, but out on the street where, I mean, they might not all walk into walls, but they're busy. It's like they don't have enough time to keep up with the cell phone messages.
Well, and they're not participating in the physical reality all around them. I was in New Mexico a few weeks ago, and I went to Old Town Albuquerque, which is this beautiful, you know, original old town, you know, western,
right,
you know, cowboy town, and they've got a park. They've got this plaza mill, this beautiful park, and all these trees, and it was just gorgeous. And I was shocked, even for me. I was shocked. I walk into this plaza area, and there are probably 150 people there, and I'm not kidding you. Probably 98% of them were sitting there on their frickin' cell phones, looking at their cell phones, doing whatever, and not participating in the wonderful reality around them. Not looking at the beautiful.
Probably
park.
Not even aware of where they were.
No, and not looking at the shops, not looking at all these cool Mexican artifacts or Southwestern artifacts and things in these various shops. Not, you know, I mean, there were people in some of the restaurants and things, but it just blew my mind that there's this huge body of people just sitting around on their freaking cell phones when they're clearly tourists visiting this tourist attraction. You know, local people don't go there and hang out. I mean, maybe occasionally, but not that caliber. So that is precisely right. It's part of the transhumanism first. You
right,
know,
right.
Give
so if you want to control
devices.
A society, you could detach them from nature by putting headphones and cell phones on all of them and put computers in the cell phones so that it's not just email and phone calls, but it's an endless something that's grabbing your attention. And
well, it's also a virtual reality that the people lose their ability to differentiate between what's real and what's not.
Yeah, well, their brain assumes it's real, I guess, right?
Absolutely. The unconscious mind can't tell it's not.
Yeah. Yeah, and so when it comes down to drug addiction of various kinds, and, you know, the electronics being one form of drug with the virtual reality on different levels, and giving up drugs is experienced as difficult because you get used to whatever it is the drug's giving you, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if somebody wants you to give it up and go back to nature so that you can start healing yourself, it becomes a question of drug detox, withdrawal, and rehabilitation. It's just which drugs are you talking about?
Right. And, you know, there are so many things in nature that we don't even realize that heal us. Colors, for example, you know, it's been shown the color green, when it comes into the eyes, it heals the thyroid, it heals the endocrine glands.
Right.
Trees are scalar wave antennas. They're capturing this energy coming from the center of the earth, coming down from the cosmos, and then broadcasting out in an auroral field around themselves. So you're walking around immersed in all these very healing toroidal fields, these scalar fields, you know, water, if you're around or in natural water, it's going to have ormus in it, which is going to be healing. Of course, the sounds of nature, those are very healing and de-stressing. And, you know, nobody goes to New York City to, you know, for a retreat. Nobody goes to New York City to heal up.
Yeah.
It's like when you got... You know, especially if your nerves are shot, you know, you get out in nature if you're smart.
Right. And just in case there's anybody left in the audience who doesn't think we're completely crazy at this point, that the trees that you just said are scalar energy antennae are also, what I've found, is that they're also conscious.
And oh, absolutely.
There's communication happening all the time between different kinds of life forms.
Yeah, and I mean, if that sounds crazy to you, Peter Tompkins did empirical science showing that not only are plants, not only are they conscious, but they can read human minds. They not just human minds.
Yeah, well, there's no intellectual chatter stopping them from doing that.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
And he's the guy who wrote that book with Christopher Bird, right?
Right, The Secret Life of Plants.
Yeah, yeah, which, and another one too, Secrets of the Soil also.
Yeah, and then Stevie Wonder did the soundtrack for that, which was interesting. When I was in high school, you know, I went to inner city, predominantly African-American schools, and, you know, Stevie Wonder was huge, and his album when it came out, The Secret Life of Plants, I think it's Journey into the Secret Life of Plants, it was huge with us, you know, and we had no idea what we were plugging into, but right. He created that album for the soundtrack to the movie The Secret Life of Plants, which you can see on YouTube.
I didn't even know it was there. Okay.
Yeah. So if you question or are skeptical about the fact that plants are sentient, just check that book out. Check that movie out.
Right. Right. So let's think of a bottom line for, you know, putting a positive spin on the whole thing, in the sense that there's infinite opportunity for people every second to start reversing this drug addiction programming that we're getting in our consciousness, that's making us miss not only what's going on around us, but what we really are. If we decide we're interested in finding out about that, what do people do?
Well, I actually created an audio CD years ago called Escape from Alcatraz, Breaking Free of Your Mind Prison. And the hilarious thing is, we almost never sell any. It hardly sells at all, because people don't believe they have a mind prison. They don't believe that they're trapped in a mind prison. They don't understand the concept of mind control. But in that audio, some of the things I recommend are, number one, unplug from television, whether it's, you know, Netflix or whatever kind of subscription service, or Hulu or whatever the heck it is you're watching. Unplug from that crap. Get rid of it. You know, get rid of your television.
Yeah.
One of the things that Bob Boyd showed in his presentation at the Tesla Tech Conference was how these LCD monitors, particularly the smart TVs, can spy on you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, but just unplug from it. Get away from it. You know, when I first got rid of my television, I mean, I got rid of it. I didn't stop watching it. I threw it away.
Yeah.
And for the first couple months, I didn't know what to do with myself.
Right.
You know, because I was watching like 2-3 hours of TV every night after work.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Most, right. You know, most wage slaves. It's like you go work all day, you come home, you know, either prepare some dinner and dump it out of a can, or buy it from a restaurant or wherever, and then you got no energy, so you fall out in front of the tube for a few hours, and then you go to sleep, and you do it all over again.
Yeah, exactly right. Right.
So unplug from television, from all these media, unplug from them. Unplug from your cell phone. Use a cell phone as a phone, and use it when you need it. Don't surf the web. Don't do emails. Don't be texting. I mean, obviously, if you really need it for business or whatever, you know, minimize it. But even for business, you don't really have to have it all the time. It's like people know. They're not going to be able to contact me through my cell phone. I have a cell phone. I'm not a Luddite. I use it when I'm traveling. I use GPS on it, those kinds of things. And that's it. I use about 90 minutes a month on a busy month on my cell phone.
Right. Right.
And people can't fathom that, because they're using their phones as computers.
Yeah,
get a computer.
Exactly. Right.
Use a computer. You know, don't use your phone as a computer. And the main reason, aside from being plugged into it mentally, is that it is a microwave transceiver, and it is emanating harmful radiation that is damaging your brain and damaging every cell in your body.
Right,
and that,
right,
there's a whole right. That's a whole talk right there on that subject.
Yeah, sometime we'll really focus on that, because they need, if they're going to drop that stuff, they really need to do something about getting Wi-Fi out of their house as well, right?
Right, exactly. Wi-Fi is a big one, you know, and And again, you don't have to be a Luddite. You don't have to not have Wi-Fi. And even if you don't have Wi-Fi, you might be in a neighborhood where you're surrounded by 20 Wi-Fi signals from your neighbors.
Yeah.
So I've made technologies to protect against that kind of stuff. You know, I've got a device called a Rest Shield that will protect against that kind of stuff.
Nice.
So there's that kind of thing. Then there are also courses or workshops or meditations that you can do, depending on your budget of time and money,
mm-hmm.
that will really help you unplug and heal emotionally and clear unconscious programming. One of my favorites, because it's fast, is Landmark Education. You can Google that and you can find them. They have courses all over the United States and all over the world. And I think their intro course runs about $500, $600 for a 3.5-day course, which a lot of people can't afford. But for those that can, you can get a whole lot done in 3.5 days if you participate fully and do what they tell you.
What do they teach you there, just out of curiosity?
Well, basically what they do is they have a facilitator who lectures and basically explains to you how you've gotten to the point where you are in your life and how to undo it and, you know, the parts that you don't like.
Yeah, and then, yeah, yeah.
And then they... As they're lecturing from time to time, they ask you to share what you're getting out of it with your neighbor sitting next to you, or at times they'll have you come up. And, I mean, it's all volunteer. You don't have to come up and do this,
yeah,
but they have
yeah.
people come up and speak in front of the audience and tell them what they're getting out of what they're being taught.
Okay.
And then they have you call people during breaks or at the end of the day and resolve unresolved issues with other people, whoever they may be. That's their intro course called the Forum.
Okay.
And it is absolutely phenomenal, you know, and they get an extremely high degree, like 90% or better of the people that go through that say that it profoundly improves their life.
Wow.
And I've sent many, many clients over the years and many friends and myself and my family through those courses, and they're absolutely amazing. And they have a whole series of, they've got tons of different courses for various things. So Landmark is a fantastic one.
Okay.
But if you don't have that kind of money, then there's Vipassana meditation,
mm-hmm.
which is a meditation technique that Buddha reportedly used to attain enlightenment. It's extremely simple to do. There's no dogma involved. It doesn't matter what you believe with your, you know, religion or whatever. It's like you can be devoutly Catholic or whatever,
mm-hmm.
and it won't affect your beliefs, because all it is sitting on your butt for anywhere from 1 to 4 hours at a time for 12 hours a day for 10 days straight. You take a vow of silence, and you meditate, you know, during those times. You meditate, and all you do is observe your breath coming out of your nostrils.
So it's a retreat where you withdraw from absolutely everything, basically.
Correct. It's a retreat. And here's the kicker. Because people, when they used to do consults, people would come to me and they say, I don't have any money. It's like, no problem. Because they don't charge for Vipassana. They give you a place to stay. They feed you. And they give you a place to meditate. And you don't have to pay for it, because the people that have come before you have paid your way.
Wow, incredible.
And at the end of the 10 days, they tell people how much it costs. I think it's like $180 to host a person for 10 days, which is
okay.
extremely cheap. You know, $18
yeah.
a day, are you
yeah.
kidding me? You can't even get,
yeah.
what can you get for $18 a day?
Right.
You can't even get a flea bag hotel on a bus station.
No, not anymore. 50 years ago, maybe.
Yeah. And so... So they tell you, you know, that you, if you want to donate, you can. And the truth is that most people are so profoundly moved and healed by the experience that they gladly donate. When I went through it the first time, I donated enough money. My wife and I donated enough money for 6 people to go after us.
Wow. Nice.
We were so moved by it.
Wow.
And other people will donate their time to help, you know, prepare food or help with the setup of the facility or whatever. So
yeah.
there are various ways. But it's extremely high integrity. There's no dogma involved. It doesn't matter. They don't preach about any kind of belief system or anything. There's no strings attached. You just come and sit on your butt, and you observe your breath for 12 hours a day.
Wow.
And it's a profound experience. It's one of the most healing and most profound experiences I've ever done. And so every few years, I go and do it.
I can imagine it would be incredibly refreshing and relieving.
It is. And in ways you can't even understand. It's like, you know, I mean, I still can't really wrap my head around it completely because, you know, you go do it. And then what I found was, like, the first time I did it, my wife and I weren't getting along. We were arguing all the time. We go do it, and it was like, it was like an emotional enema. We come out of it, we're just happy to be alive. We're just grateful to be alive.
Wow.
And you would see people, and it lasted. It lasted, you know, like 2 years later, my wife and I were in a situation where, you know, we were having a conversation about something, and I thought, wow, this is amazing. You know, 2 years ago, we would have gotten into a big argument over this. And it's like, absolutely none of that's going on.
Wow, wow.
So it's very deeply, it affects you very deeply at a cell level, and not just a cell level, but an energetic level. You know, we don't have time, unfortunately, to talk about what the experience that I had, but it was like, I saw the energetic body, I saw the subatomic structure of the body, and I was able to affect it with my mind and get rid of pain and all kinds of stuff.
Right.
When I was doing it. And I can see how it was the method that Buddha supposedly attained enlightenment with, because average people, unless you've gone through an experience like that, you can't even comprehend what it really does. You have the ability to alter matter in your body. You have the ability to deeply, deeply heal and release emotional issues from birth and maybe even before birth.
Mm-hmm.
And beyond. So that's, Vipassana is always one of my favorites, because when people tell me, well, I can't afford Landmark, or I can't afford, you know, rebirthing or whatever else,
yeah,
I say, well, go do Vipassana, because it doesn't cost anything except 10 days of your time.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So for people that don't have a lot of time, go do Landmark. People that don't have a lot of money, go do Vipassana.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, unplug from your TV. There's many, many more things you could do, but those are good things to start with.
Yeah, so instead of, you know, for all the problems in your life and all the things that you have wanted to be distracted from because you don't want to feel that you're uncomfortable with things, it's not like you have to create the solution because it's already there. What you have to do is stop blocking it, which all these things are for, right?
Right, and in the case of Vipassana, there's no logical process to it. There's no emotional process to it, really. It's just doing this procedure. It's just observing your breath.
Yeah,
that's all you do. But that sends you through this amazing transformation, because you wind up having these experiences you cannot have. I don't know of any other way. I mean, I did a lot of drugs when I was young. I never had an experience like that. It's way more interesting than doing drugs.
Yeah.
So, you know, you have to experience it. It cannot be explained in words.
Yeah. The experience that's going to solve things is already waiting inside every single person.
Right. And so, when you have had that experience,
yeah,
then you can understand when you hear masters talking about these concepts, you understand what they're saying. It's like a good example, Gabriel Cousins' book, Spiritual Nutrition.
Mm-hmm.
That's like a encoded message. If you've never done meditation and you haven't had these kinds of experiences and you read Spiritual Nutrition, you won't know what the heck Gabriel's talking about half the time.
Right.
But he's talking about these very profound experiences that you can only get through doing deep meditation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it unlocks a whole world that most people don't even know exist.
Yeah, I think that's the ultimate, you know, encouragement for everybody, is that the reality that they're not experiencing yet is something really good, and they're definitely going to get to it one way or the other.
Right, and the point of doing this is not to be holy or anything like that. It's not to be spiritual. The point of it is to explore and understand the nature of reality and consciousness so that you can navigate through life much easier.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And, of course, in the process of doing that, you release a lot of emotional stuff, a lot of emotional baggage, a lot of mental baggage, and a lot of unconscious programming that's self-destructive or self-defeating.
Yeah.
And so when you do that, the point of doing this is very, very practical. It's to get more done, to have a better life, to be happy, to have more fun, to, you know, sleep better, on and on and on.
And that's all possible because the real stress that is wiping everybody out and making things seem hopeless is not coming from circumstances or other people. It's coming from this stuff on the inside.
Right. Which is why all great teachers have always said, know thyself, go within,
yeah,
et cetera.
Yeah, it wasn't just a cool thing to say.
No. that's how you develop your own power.
Right, right. I think ultimately that's where the solution is for turning things around in the outside world.
Absolutely. And that's why there's so much distraction through media and everything else and phones
right.
and tablets.
Make sure that you won't figure this out.
Right. And to keep you focused on the external world.
Yes, because by the time your life is over, you will have missed your opportunity.
Right.
And the people who want something different for the outside world can do what they want destructively without us getting in the way. But I think it wouldn't take millions of us accessing these internal things to totally change things for the better.
No, it only takes a small minority. People say about 10% of the population. It may not even be that much.
Yeah, probably even less, and it would just revolutionize everything. So, in fact, one single person of, you know, anybody that's left listening to us after all this stuff, every single individual has so much power in them, it probably can't even be measured at all. That whoever the person is that's listening could radically change the future of the world by doing exactly what we're talking about.
Well, and even if they don't want to change the world, they can change their world.
Yeah,
they
yeah,
can make
exactly.
their world be uplifting. You know, this was something actually that was drilled in my head over and over again by these reptilians. Because they said, the closer you get to 2012, the more and more and more that things are going to accelerate in your world, and the more and more chaos there's going to be, and the more and more strife. And you've got to learn how to not plug into that and not buy into it, not be in denial of it, understand it, know that it's there, acknowledge it, and even so, maintain your balance and your happiness by very consciously creating your reality.
Yeah.
And that's the point of all of this stuff. The point of all these things is, particularly amidst the chaos of the world, to create an uplifting, happy life.
Yeah, you can be aware of the outside and still live in your own created world.
Right. And you don't have to be in denial of anything that's going on. As a matter of fact, I'm acutely more aware of horrible things in this world than most people are, because I've seen them.
Right.
You know, I've seen a lot of stuff. I've traveled around the world. I've seen things, lots and lots of things. I've seen horrible things, and I've experienced horrible things. You know, I've had attempts on my life. I've had death threats, you know, and yet I'm not going to let that make me cower or be negative or fearful or angry or any of that stuff.
Right, exactly.
Too many lessons.
And that's actually on an energetic level the best defense that I've ever found against anything.
True. It's very true.
If it can't tie into the corresponding energy in you, it's very hard to do what it wants do to you.
That's right. That's right. You know, it's like... there's a very good example. Is I remember many years ago, probably 20 years ago, I was living in North Carolina, and I was out in this rural town. Some guy holding himself up in his house, and he had his guns, and he was holding his family hostage, and he was threatening to kill them.
Mm-hmm.
And the police were surrounding his house, and you know they all had their guns pointing at him. And in the course of this exchange, the family had a puppy. And the puppy just comes strolling out of the house like it was no big deal and, you know, walks right out to the police.
Right, right.
Amidst this extremely tense reality, very potentially deadly reality, and here's this puppy just like, la, 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 and it never affected his reality.
Yeah, yeah.
And that is kind of how we have to be. Yes, there's lots of pain and misery in the world. Yes, we have nuclear fallout all over the place. Yes, we have war, and we have poverty, and we have... torment, and we have misery and pain everywhere, and we can help to improve that, but we also do not have to let that make us be sad or depressed or not want to live or unhappy, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, that part's voluntary.
Yeah. I mean, I've spent my life, I've dedicated the last few decades of my life to helping uplift humanity and to teach people how to heal and detoxify their bodies, their minds, their emotions, and how to have an uplifting life. And yet I know I've seen all this pain and suffering in the world, and I've experienced a good dose of it myself, but I do not allow it to wreck my world.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And everyone has that ability, even if they're not familiar with it at the moment.
Right, and the more that you heal, the easier that becomes.
Yeah, exactly. Everything becomes easier. So, okay, well, we need to wrap it up, but let's leave people with your website and any other things that you want them to go look at.
Well, let's see. My website is freshandalive.com. My blog is freshandaliveblog.com. That's and is spelled out A-N-D.
Okay.
I'm doing an event at the end of October here in Florida in New Smyrna Beach with Dr. Stephen West, who is an absolutely brilliant, brilliant healer who is an expert in lymphology and speed healing. This guy does amazing work in healing stuff really fast, like sometimes in seconds or minutes. This guy has helped people heal things very, very quickly, like major stuff. And so we're going to be doing an event. I'm going to be hosting him here in the New Smyrna Beach area. At the end of October, I think it's actually the 28th and 29th of May. So
okay.
That's the only event that I have going on other than a couple of local talks. But anything I do will be on my website, and my mailing list will be notified. So if you want to know about what I'm doing, just get on my mailing list. And you'll
Yeah, good. And that's on the main website, right?
Correct.
Okay. Okay. Well, sounds great. We've got at least, 10 other things that were brought up that could be whole programs, so hopefully we'll get to do the next chapter before long.
Okay.
So, yeah, thank you, Ken. Hold on, and we'll say goodbye in the break here.
All right. Thanks, Richard.
All right. Okay, so there goes Ken Rohla, and remember I said the discussion would lead in unusual directions, and that turned out to be true. I think you would agree with that. Anything can come up, and I have to comment on the idea that, again, there's so many patterns and themes here that I want to bring up. We only have a few minutes, but I just want to mention that the idea of ETs and aliens is really not any big unusual deal to me, because in my experience, life is absolutely everywhere. And the fact that we experience and perceive through our senses and our mind that interprets the sense data, this very limited, even if you look at the electromagnetic spectrum that the colors are on, and you have infrared and ultraviolet and X-ray and all these different frequencies of energies that we do recognize, the part of it that we perceive with our senses is basically nothing. And who's to say that that spectrum is all there is? I think that would be a really ridiculous joke. It's so obviously false that it wouldn't even qualify as a good joke. There are spectra on top of spectra and different frequencies and different dimensions. All of it is full of life because it all came from consciousness. There's no other source of anything. So, and I'm not saying this because I memorized it somewhere. This is my experience so far, and there are people that have gone much, much farther into it than I have, and they say the same thing. So life is everywhere, and who's to say that somebody different from us is the aliens? How silly. Don't you think that they could call us aliens just as easily? It's like a bug looking at us and saying that, the ultimate answer is this giant bug, because that's the way they think. And there are a few things that the bugs aren't thinking of because there are other possibilities. So other life forms, as I talked to Ken about, there's no obligation on our part to be afraid of anything. It's programming, and it's completely voluntary. You can have a 100-foot person from somewhere else that we may call an alien or not show up next to you. If they're malicious and they kill you, then they kill you. How is it going to help to be afraid? And if you're not afraid, you may be able to pick up a form of communication that your fear would block out. So I would propose that fear is useless and counterproductive. And I would recommend that we all do our best to give it up. Because right now, our creativity is really needed. And for us to come up with solutions, because our rulers The only kind of solutions they want to come up is the kind that will destroy us. So that leaves us, right? If we're not going to think of solutions, then it's unreasonable for us to think of anybody else is going to do it for us. And Ken brought up some interesting things. I think it would be great for people to play around with that inductive technology that he discussed on, you know, the Farberware or other brand of hot plate that you can get. That's not a hot plate, it's an inductive, you know, magnetic type thing that will induce a magnetic field in a special cooking container that you put on it. But if instead of the cooking container you put a certain kind of coil of wire on there, and you can listen to the archive again if you need to review the details. Ken says that produces over unity energy, and he has no reason to make that up. If that's true, that one thing is a big deal, but there are many, many others, and some are far more advanced than magnetic induction. I've had some contact with these, but there's this little problem that the inventors or the holders of the technology are all terrified and hiding. And they're not terrified of ETs. They're terrified of the people in top positions of our government and its partner corporations, global corporations. And that's a situation that our creativity is really needed for right now, because we need an answer to that. These individual fields like energy and medicine and food production and communications and all this stuff, the problems in those areas are pretty much all coming from the same place. And that is a malevolent cartel, you know, people have said maybe a few thousand people globally who are controlling everybody else, 7+ billion. And that's pretty ridiculous. I mean, what does it say about us that we're allowing that to happen? I mean, part of it, it's really not our fault, because the normal person doesn't relate to these focused, coordinated beings whose only purpose over generations and lifetimes is to enslave and exterminate humanity. I mean, mostly we wouldn't relate to something like that, and that makes them camouflaged. But if we do, you know, if we don't let the discovery of what's really going on get us upset, afraid, angry, frustrated, despairing, anything like that, separate out your emotional connection to what you love and are inspired by and leave it there unwaveringly, if that's a good word, no matter what you're having to look at in the world around you, then you can afford to look at what's going on and see what we have to fix. And the first step is breaking through your own programming, throwing off your own addictions, and every one of us has them. If you think it's only other people, you know, you want to look at drug addicts who are obvious and critique them, you're wasting your time. If you want the power to do something good, all that energy has to turn back on yourself. And then you have to learn and follow the laws of nature. And the result, if you stick on that and really do it in your life, and I'm speaking of myself and everybody else, the result is a new level of power for healing, and new information, inspiration, high energy levels, new ideas, new abilities, and then you can use them to help the outside world, which means everybody else. And we've already talked about the idea that if you really care about yourself and you really want to be selfish, which is absolutely fine and normal, the best way to do it is to pour out everything you can do for everybody around you, not some special select group, but the people who just show up in your life around you every day. Do everything you can out of kindness for every single one of them without criticism or judgment, regardless of what you see them doing or not doing, for their benefit, because that's where the cure lies. And if we get strong enough in that consciousness, we're not limited by anything as far as fixing this situation that we find ourselves in. So we're about out of time. So I just want to remind you, next Saturday we've got our call-in show again, 8 o'clock in the morning Pacific time, 11 o'clock Eastern. Please call in. You can talk to me live and we can go over any of these ideas or other ideas about health, life, consciousness, anything that's important to you, and we can talk live on the air. You can also listen at 657-383-1002 or call in and ask questions on that line. And then the Sunday show will be another incredible guest. If you sign up for the free newsletter, you'll get advance notice of this, assuming I get it out on time, which I'll try to do. The free video subscription service is also still open on the video subscribers tab on lostartsradio.com. Donate to our work there if you can afford it, and let other people know about the show. Visit Doug's site, diamonddiscaudio.com. And we're wishing you a really great week. Grateful that you're spending some time with us, and look forward to talking to you again next Saturday. Have a good week.
If you'd like to support Lost Arts Radio, one brand new way that you can do that is by becoming a monthly subscriber to our new video subscription service. Richard is committed to making daily or several times a week short educational videos that will only be available to you if you're a monthly subscriber. The subscription cost is just $4.99 per month, and it's paid via PayPal, so you can use your PayPal account or any major credit card. To sign up, simply go to lostartsradio.com and click the video subscribers button along the menu at the top of any page and sign up right there. We will then send you your own personal login, and you can then access these new videos as Richard adds them to our site. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/lostartsradio.
And smile.